A world gone insane. An upside-down civilization cannot be real. A world of madness and terror.
It's the Dana Gould Hour.
Trick or treat, trick or treat, trick or treat on Halloween. Trick or treat on Halloween. Never any tricks, but lots of treats on your Halloween station. Here's a salutation. A musical treat from your Halloween station. Happy Halloween!
Tune in, it's a gas. It's the Dana Gould Hour.
It is indeed Halloween, the most wonderful time of the year, and as always, it's the episode of the podcast that we hope will stand head and shoulders above the rest. And this episode is no exception. The writers of Ed Wood, as well as Man on the Moon, The People vs. Larry Flynt, The People vs. O.J. Simpson, Autofocus, and the soon-to-be-streaming and currently in theaters Eddie Murphy, Tour de Force, Dolemite Is My Name, Scott Alexander and Larry Karaszewski are here. In addition, Dr. Herbert West himself, Re-Animator's Jeffrey Combs is here. He'll be talking about Re-Animator, his time in the Star Trek universe, as well as his amazing one-man show about Edgar Allan Poe. Additionally, the host of the Monster Party podcast, Matt Weinhold, is here. He'll be joined by writer, director, and friend of our podcast, Mike Mendez, as they will be discussing the year in horror movies. And as usual, there is so much, much more. As for me, we are busy here at Gould Co. It is, after all, that time of year. If you live in the Los Angeles area on October 29th at Largo at the Coronet, it is our annual Halloween tradition, Plan 9 from Outer Space Live. This year starring me, Bobcat Goldthwait, Janet Varney, Matt Bronger, Tom Kenny, Jonah Ray, Lorraine Newman, Paul F. Tompkins, Stephen Weber, G. Charles Wright, Ron Lynch, David Koechner, Jackie Harris Greenberg, and Catherine Augustin, with live music by the inimitable Eben Schletter. One night only, October 29th in Los Angeles at Largo. In November, I will be in St. Louis at Helium from the 7th to the 9th. From the 14th to the 16th, I will be back in Boston at the Boston Comedy Festival. And on November 21st, 2nd, and 3rd, I will be in beautiful Minneapolis, Minnesota at Acme Comedy Company. I can't wait for that gig. I love going to Minneapolis. December 26th, 7th, and 8th, I will be back in San Francisco at the Good Old Punchline, which is still open, thanks to Dave Chappelle. For ticket links and information for all of these and other shows, please go to danagould.com/events and get a full calendar with ticket links. You will also see a link to our Patreon page. Last month, our Patreon fans got access to a complete interview with smooth-skinned, almond-eyed podcast ingenue Eddie Pepitone, just for our Patreoners. This month, you can enjoy my Halloween mixes. What are they, you say? Several years ago, I put together a bunch of CDs of vintagey, weird old Halloween music that I had collected. You know, not Monster Mash, but weird stuff like Black Cat by Tommy Collins, or Skeleton in the Closet by Louis Armstrong, or the same song by British big band leader Matt Ginella. You know, weird stuff, about three CDs worth, and I would make them up and send them to my friends. Well, this month, Our Patreon followers have access to all of those files and more, and it's only $5 a month. $5 a month, you get a little extra, you get some stuff. It's pretty good. I don't want to do 800 levels for $50. I'll come to your house and make you a sandwich for $89. We can take a bath together. It's $5. You give me $5, I'll give you some stuff. And it's like I'm with you all the time. In the car, in your apartment, on the toilet. But in the meantime, kids are here. We're in Tony Beverly Hills, California.
Did we start?
Yeah, we're talking.
Okay.
When I introduce you, just say this is the sound of my voice.
We've been on this show before.
Right. And we're here with the screenwriter of, among many other great films, Man in the Moon, People versus O.J. Simpson, Big Eyes, Ed Wood, The People versus Larry Flynt, Screwed with Dave Chappelle and Norm MacDonald. Problem Child 2, produced Autofocus.
There you go.
Scott Alexander.
What?
Larry Karaszewski.
Hey there.
Perfect.
Right. I'm not going to do it a third time.
No, you don't want to. Dolemite in theaters now.
Yes.
Streaming on Netflix in
October 25th.
Sure. October 25th.
When is this episode dropping?
October 20th.
All right.
It's perfect.
Right. See, folks, have 5 days to see it in the theater. If,
is there a little extra cake in it for you if they see it in the theater?
Zero extra cake.
Just enjoyment. You get to see it with a crowd.
Yeah, and comedies, it's very, like, I saw it in the theater. Comedies, when you see them with a crowd, they're just funnier. You know, it's laughter is infectious, you're in the dark.
Yeah.
It's a very, very different, different experience.
You're a stand-up. Have you ever done a stand-up show to one person?
Pretty much. Yeah. It's called dating. Yeah. It's called a date.
Called last night.
But the lights is a big part of it. Like, it's dark and people laugh more in the dark.
But if you were working
once again, dating
once again, yeah.
So if you were working that last slot at a club, hypothetically, and everyone leaves except that one lonely guy.
Yeah.
Are the jokes going to land?
Well, usually the one lonely guy is the guy on the stage.
I will say, here's the thing. The movie Dolemite Is My Name plays insane when you see what a gigantic crowd, but we've shown it in so many different ways now that it plays really well with just, you know, a group of 10 people. It plays well just by yourself. I mean,
yeah, it's so funny, but it's also, it's, as I said to you guys, it's really beautiful. We met through
Michael Lehman.
Yes. And we met through, but, and we, the thing we talked about was Ed Wood that
correct,
Michael also
correct,
worked
yes,
on.
Correct.
Yeah. And, movie that I love so much. And we've talked about before, and you could argue that Rudy Ray Moore is the Black Ed Wood, although he wasn't a director.
Right.
But
well,
it's a similar, it's
Rudy Ray Moore,
similar
is that,
story.
Is that he's the auteur of his films.
But doesn't direct any.
He doesn't direct them. He doesn't write them.
That is astounding.
Yes. Yes,
yeah.
But he has just such a force field of personality.
Right. And an indomitable personality. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, that all 90 minutes of the movies just reflect who Rudy is and what he likes.
Yes.
Yeah, and there are scenes in Dolemite where Eddie Murphy is playing Rudy Ray Moore, and they're writing Dolemite, and he is like, "There's got to be kung fu in the movie." Right. And is that how he wrote him? Like, did he sit with?
I don't know. We made it up.
Yeah,
yeah. But oh, so you don't?
I mean,
that
no,
much,
we
yeah.
do. We do.
We
do,
know what Jerry's like.
Yeah, we met Jerry Jones, the real Jerry Jones, and
right.
we met the real Rudy,
and we've got playbills from a lot of Jerry's plays, and they were all
right.
very serious.
Yeah.
So we could imagine the funny of those two guys trying to collaborate on a scene.
Right. But what I mean is that Rudy would collaborate.
Like I'm sure Rudy expressed his vision to Jerry what the movies would be.
It's got
to
have kung fu, it's got to have a car chase.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Rudy's movie has have a certain thing in all of them.
Yeah.
And Jerry's plays did not have that thing.
Right.
Jerry's plays were very sincere, very much about...
they didn't have kung fu.
Yeah, they didn't have kung fu.
They never... Like, in none of Jerry's plays did a man do an amazing stunt, stop the play in the middle of the stunt. go backwards through thin air.
That's correct.
Which is, that's from Human Tornado, right?
Yeah, I believe so.
Yeah, for those of you who don't know, in the Rudy
it's
Ray
in our
Moore
film as well. I mean, we did.
Yeah,
we tried as much as possible to be as honest as possible in this movie. But the one thing we did do as a cheat was there are certain films that we show them filming that are actually from the Human
it's
Tornado.
It's an amalgam.
We sort of felt like you're going to make a Rudy Ray Moore movie. You've got to include some of the greatest hits.
Well,
we got to please the fans.
Yeah, well, the way the story goes, like, yeah, if you only had one movie in Ed Wood, it would have a little bit of Glenn or Glenda in it, it would have a little bit of Plan 9. For those of you who are completely unfamiliar with Rudy Ray Moore, he was a comedian who had these crazy albums in the early
albums.
70s. Party, not comedy albums, party albums. Right. And then he went into
X-rated party albums.
Very X-rated, but like.
And party albums, for those who don't know. They sound like they take place in a party,
right?
And then I think you're supposed to play them at a party.
Yeah, and they're beautiful in the sense that it's just unremitting filth, but in a way that's hilarious. I mean, they're great,
yeah.
And they're so raunchy and so sensuous.
Did you grow up with those at all?
I didn't get into them until I moved. After I went to college, my parents moved to Cape Cod. And then, so the summers that when I was in college, I would spend in Hyannis. And that's when I, started hanging out
with the Kennedys.
Well, it's funny. No,
they started on Rudy Ray Moore.
So I started hanging out with black kids. And that introduced me to Rudy Ray Moore and all of that stuff.
Well, it's funny. I didn't know Rudy stuff in the 70s. I certainly love blaxploitation movies and things like that, but Dolemite never reached South Bend, Indiana. But I did know about the X-rated records. They were always behind the counter at the record store, and I actually became obsessed with a guy named Wildman Steve.
Sure,
one of Rudy's contemporaries, and as actually in, I believe, Petey Wheatstraw.
And we slipped his name into some playbills in the background.
Because,
good for you,
Because
I heard of Wildman Steve.
I just, me and my friends were obsessed with Wildman Steve records.
Sure,
particularly one called The Great Insult with him, Wildman Steve, and a guy named Gene Mr. Truckstop Tracy. Where Gene Mr. Truckstop Tracy was this kind of white racist comedian, Southern comedian, and Wildman Steve was this sort of like guy who wore these white suits, and so they would go on stage and battle each other in terms of trying to out.
Right,
out
so it's sort of like a Dozens, like
yes,
a live
correct.
Dozen
totally
show.
Like a Dozen.
So they're on stage together.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it is like Sensuous Black Man was an album that my friend Shay played for me on Cape Cod, and it's like getting hit. Like you see these films of kids like loosening the bolts on a fire hydrant, like in the summer to cool off, and the way the water comes out of the fire. Sensuous Black Man is like that with filth. It's just this unrelenting tornado of raunchiness. It's so, and it is. It's like a Goon Show album, and like it's so dirty. It starts off hilarious, and then you almost get numb to it, and then it gets funny again. It's won't stop.
It does wear you out at a certain point.
Yeah,
you know, but
boy, I remember just hanging out at my friend's house, just holding our sides.
Is that the same as the Zodiac album?
I think it might be. We didn't know Rudy though that much until a friend of ours, another screenwriter, Daniel Waters,
who wrote a little movie called Batman Returns, exactly. Among other things.
Yeah, there were six of us living in a house in Silver Lake. Just as a real estate anecdote, $1,200 a month for six bedrooms,
right?
With a view of the lake.
Yes,
$200 a guy.
What year was that?
1985.
Okay,
and
that was sort of like the Pato guys Redux.
Correct.
Exactly. Okay. We were the East Side version.
Right.
And
where was the Pato guys?
Weren't they around Hancock Park?
Something like that. Yeah. We were more.
Yeah, you were more downtown.
Yeah. And
as
Dan
well,
was
you
running
should be.
A video store, and he came home with this compilation called The Best of Sex and Violence, which is just.
Which I called my parents' marriage.
Wow. Wow. Right. It was 2 hours of trailers, and it had Dolemite, Human Tornado, and Disco Godfather.
Uh-huh.
And for those of you listening, when you're finished, go on YouTube and look up the trailer for Human Tornado. It's 3 minutes of being hit upside the head.
Yeah.
It is just so insane. And because our roommate managed the store, we didn't have to return the tape. And we kept it, and we kept inviting friends over saying, just sit down, we need to show you something.
Yep.
And it those trailers brought us such joy. Then a couple years later, an obscure company called Xenon Video got the rights to Rudy, and I heard they were out on VHS, but before the internet, you don't know where to find anything.
Right.
And so for Larry's birthday, I opened up the old white pages. Yep. I looked up Xenon Video out in Santa Monica. I drove out to their warehouse, and I just showed up with money.
That's amazing.
Saying, I'm here to buy videotapes.
That's sir, we don't make change here. We're not.
Really, yeah, we're not a retailer.
We don't have a cash register.
And but they sold you.
They were so tickled that just this, yeah. This, you know, this 19-year-old white guy had wandered in.
Yeah, no, that was I understand that completely. There is a scene in Human Tornado where he, I don't know if he falls out of a car, he jumps, but he's falling over. It's a stunt, and he's falling down like the on ramp of an interstate or like a big hill. And he in the movie, you're watching the movie, and the movie stops, and you hear him say,
"You don't believe I did that? Good shit.
Well, check out this good shit.
Yeah, yeah. Check out this good shit." And then they rewind and do it again.
When it flashes.
No, I know, but it's just, like, I'm trying to relate to the listener how insane these movies are.
And, and what's great is it's Rudy with his bragging saying, "You don't believe that was me?" Well, it actually wasn't him.
No. Of course not.
That's what's so beautiful.
Yeah, exactly.
And we took it at face value, and we watched that clip about 100 times back and forth and back and forth. And we thought, that isn't Rudy Ray Moore. He's the guy's too short, and he's actually pudgier.
Jumping out. He's running away from the sheriff with a shotgun. He's jumping out of a house in the hill.
Blaxploitation films came out of the mid to late 60s. They really reached their prime in the 70s.
Early 70s.
But the genesis of them was...
Fleabag is sort of the first one, and it makes so much money that the studios started dipping their toes in. And, you know, MGM releases Shaft.
Shaft
was like the... Warner Brothers releases Superfly. And those two become...
huge money
printing machines, basically. Right. Both as films and also as soundtrack albums.
The soundtrack, yeah. Yeah. And it's interesting, you know, blacks were underrepresented in American film, and then they started, you know, making their own movies, and then finally got picked up by Warner Brothers, and they get released.
Well, these movies were phenomenally successful because African American audiences never seen themselves
represented on screen.
Yes, yeah. But in the sense of it, like, you know,
with a lot of power.
Sure, they were almost like those early 30s Warner Brothers gangsters movies where, you know, they sure. were that this was, you know, Richard Roundtree was their Cagney or their
it was a 30s gangster movie with turtlenecks and leather car coats.
Yeah. So they were sort of empowered in a big way, and that it connected in just gigantic.
But those are, you know, they're gangster movies, they're crime movies, but They're real movies. They're very entertaining and great movies. And then Rudy Ray Moore's movie. But those movies are insane.
Yes. What happened?
Yeah. Well, I mean, were there blaxploitation? Were there a lot of blaxploitation comedies in the early 70s?
No. I mean,
was it really? I do know that.
That's my coffee.
I'm sorry about that.
God, I do know that the Omega Man, which was Warner Brothers 1971.
Sure. Has Rosalyn Cash.
And the secondary zombies, African American, they kind of made it up.
Who was that?
Forget the character's name. Oh. But Tim basically put that character into Mrs. Peregrine's home for.
Well, there were a lot of movies that like sort of like were mainstream.
Yeah, there's like, hey, this works.
I mean, like Live and Let Die.
Absolutely, is a blaxploitation movie,
but it's really a blaxploitation.
Absolutely,
movie. It definitely tries to
say, "Jim, we're going uptown."
Oh dear.
Cotton Comes to Harlem.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. Cotton Comes to Harlem's one.
Right.
By the time it gets to Rudy, though, it's the blaxploitation era is almost ending.
It's almost ending, yeah.
And so Rudy is sort of almost a postmodern making fun of the genre.
And there was a backlash.
Sure.
I guess it was sort of – Core was an offshoot of NAACP. Right. Where they were sort of saying, enough of this negative imagery.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, and we're just seeing a lot of pimps and whores, and and we need more positive role models. And
Andrew Young was
performers were happy with it because these were jobs.
Yeah.
And as we talk about a lot in the movie, you know, the majority of the black actors and actresses and performers weren't get through the gates. Mm-hmm. They were being blocked out, and so they could get work in the blaxploitation. But by 1974, when Rudy gets around to making Dolemite,
right,
it's starting to peter out.
Yeah,
yeah.
And so, I mean, because Rudy's talents are so singular, and that he's as we say he's doughy. He's not going to be a real action star. He can't actually do a kung fu kick. He can't chase a bad guy down an alley because he probably can't run very well.
Yeah, he's
not much of a lover.
He's not overweight. He's a fat guy. He's not fat. He's out of shape.
He's out of shape. Correct. Yeah,
he's an out of shape middle aged guy.
He's
not Richard Roundtree.
he's having fun with the whole conceit of it, and that
question. Was he having fun with the whole conceit of it?
He's having fun.
Yeah, that's the thing though. But it was always on the line there that people would watch Dolemite. Unsure. We do that right. Even in the film where someone has to ask him, is this supposed to be funny? Because Rudy was a comedian. So of course
he was a comedian, but
what he says is he wanted to hit all the bases. He wanted to work as an action movie. He wanted to work as a sexy movie. He wanted to work as a comedy.
Well, I know because Eddie Murphy
kung fu.
Plays with kung fu, of course, but Eddie Murphy, who plays Rudy Ray Moore in the film, talked about when he was on tour, and he would have like, you know, Chris Rock and other, and Paul Mooney. Mm-hmm. Sorry, I was thinking of John Mulrooney, Paul Mooney,
John Witherspoon,
and Johnny Witherspoon. They would be in the tour bus listening to Eat Out More Often, which is like his first big party album, and they would debate whether or not he was taking himself seriously. Like, does he?
I can't imagine that debate being for real because the movies are so.
Well, no, the albums too. Just like as a character, like
they're also crazy and
they are fucking insane,
visceral and funny and bananas. I just can't imagine anyone could think that this was serious business.
But here's the thing: but what makes them special, both the movies and the records, are that they're one of a kind. And that's why you can even have these debates, because Rudy is just a singular creature.
Yes.
In that and I think that's why the movies have lasted, because back in the day, you know, Dolemite wasn't up there with Shaft and Superfly. It made money. It was quite successful, but it was not considered.
Well, that his movies were like his albums.
Right.
There were these things that you passed around.
Correct.
Yeah.
And so,
have you heard this? You have to hear this.
But what's happened now?
As we point out in the closing cards, I mean, the Dolemite and Human Tornado made a shitload of money. They were extremely successful at the box office, but I think. After that point, then they disappeared.
Yeah.
It's sort of like a bit of a generation.
And they played in like grindhouses
and they played in the big theaters downtown and downtown urban places, like the Woods Theater in Chicago. And
I think, as we say in the movie, every big city has them.
Right.
It's the old vaudeville palaces from the
20s. Right.
But what's amazing about Dolemite now is that it actually is considered one of the, you know, when you talk about blaxploitation, it almost is Shaft, Superfly, Dolemite. You know, it's sort of like because he's so one of a kind.
Yeah.
All the blaxploitation movies that were just trying to be average crime films have a little bit fallen away. But Dolemite is still today so jaw droppingly different.
It is like you can't take your eyes off.
So
it is like Ed Wood, and Plan 9 from Outer Space is still. Mention Beast of Yucca Flats is not,
Jim Brown and Fred Williamson starred in a hell of a lot more successful movies than Rudy ever did.
Right.
But no one watches their films anymore.
Right. No, and they are. And what is amazing is it's 2019 and you watch these movies and they're still like, Jesus Christ.
They've not lost any of the
Petey Wheatstraw. It's just like, what's happening?
Petey Wheatstraw is surrealism.
Right.
It's just from beginning.
It's a horror movie.
It can't even be described.
But I mean, I think its original intent was he's the devil's. Rudy Ray Moore plays Petey Wheatstraw. If I remember the story right, he dies, and then the devil offers him he can live again if he goes back to Earth and impregnates a woman. and right. has the devil.
Something like that. Crazy. I think the other three were more were more semi available, and the trailers were more available. And Pee Wee Straw, aka the Devil's Son-in-Law, was the, more of this movie you would hear about but couldn't see.
Well, there was no trailer. There still is no trailer. So
to Pee Wee Straw,
it took us a while to see that one.
Yeah.
Yes, and as I've said, I had a dog named Petey Wheatstraw. Right. For, it was just
the, and the you know.
By the way,
by the time even
the sweetest, right. like you know, you have dogs throughout your life, but there's two or three that really stick, that really were like, oh, that was a great dog, Petey Wheatstraw, one of those dogs.
But by the time Rudy gets to Disco Godfather, he's actually learning the lessons of the failing blaxploitation. Era where he's trying to be the good guy in this one, as opposed to a gangster element. Mm-hmm. He's fighting the drug epidemic. Right.
The love for Rudy is so strong. We had the screening. It was last night, and it was Robert Townsend and Lawrence Hill and Jacobs reminiscing. Mm. About seeing Disco Godfather at the World Theater, and they had such good memories. And that movie really isn't very good, because that's the PG,
right,
where he's trying to clean up the streets and save the kids
from Angel Dust.
And nobody wants to see that.
Yeah, you want to see Rudy,
and that's about what 79, 80,
something
or,
like that. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Well, I know that it's. I think it's, and this is one of my favorite. This is such an Ed Woodian plot twist. Mm. I think it's Human Tornado, where Leroy and Skillet. Shoot up a funeral service with machine guns, and the bone of contention is that Rudy Ray Moore, the Dolemite, wouldn't reschedule his comedy show.
Yes, yes. They're fighting over a date.
They shoot up the funeral in slow motion.
Yeah, yeah. Slow motion. Like people
are dying and dying.
People in funeral clothes falling and it's just, bloody slow motion outside a church.
Well, it is.
All of Rudy's movies are, for the most part, about the dilemmas of a nightclub.
Trying to take down
but
the
it's also just
he really was writing what he knew. He knew the nightclub world, he knew the comedy world, he knew the chitlin circuit world, so his movies are about that.
But looking at it from a point of conflict resolution, it is an orgasm of bad decisions.
I mean, Skillet and Leroy are out of line. Yes.
And Leroy and Skillet, again, like you talk about the chitlin circuit, which is depicted so...
They put out
so,
records, too. They were,
so,
they were,
yeah, Leroy and Skillet were these very popular comedians in the chitlin circuit. And the chitlin circuit...
You're saying Leroy and Skillet. Isn't it Skillet and Leroy?
Skillet and Leroy. Skillet gets the top billing, I believe.
Really?
Yeah. Sorry.
It rolls off the tongue better.
You know, we've been friends for a long time.
I don't affect you in your own show, but... Skillet and Leroy.
No, okay, Skillet and Leroy.
You were saying, and Costello and Abbott.
Yeah.
Costello and Abbott, they just were...
Scruggs and Flat.
Garfunkel and Sons.
There actually might be a show flyer around the corner here that says
Skillet. Oh, by the way...
We're totally wrong. We always do that, too. Scott and I will argue about something like, oh, no, we were wrong.
So we've agreed it's Leroy and Skillet, just so...
No. No.
But talk about, for people who don't know, like, what was the Chitlin circuit, you know, for...
The Chitlin Circuit ran through the South and then up the Eastern Seaboard, and these were clubs with black performers for black audiences. If you were the A-plus star of all time, the ultimate would be to play the Apollo.
Right.
But that's not where Rudy was.
No.
He was playing in storefronts, in barns... In living rooms
and clubs, I mean,
and clubs, but these were small. These could be improvised.
It was a network of like. Then you're going to drive to Shreveport, and this guy's showing his house.
And it lasted for a while. I mean, even after clubs got desegregated, and you know, that still became there. These were still nightclubs primarily for black people.
Yeah. In the '70s, where you're still playing them.
Yeah,
I mean, when does Dick Gregory play the Playboy Club? I mean, it's later than people think. You know, it's like mid-'60s something.
Yeah, it's mid-'60s late. Yeah. So this movie, unlike a lot of movies, this movie did Eddie Murphy brought you this idea?
Yes.
That's interesting. That was I didn't know that.
Well, Eddie brought it to us, and then we brought it to Eddie.
Yeah.
So Eddie, we got a phone call in the early 2000s.
16 years ago or so.
Yeah, that Eddie Murphy wants to meet with you guys. And we go, wow, okay, that's cool. I mean, we'd never met him. And so we go, and we sit down with him, and he starts doing scenes from Ed Wood. film. You've seen it, right?
I have seen Ed Wood.
Okay, and he starts doing Tor Johnson.
It's Edward. It's just one word.
It's Eddie Murphy doing Do My Toes.
Yeah, so we were blown away.
Eddie's got this incredible memory, and so he could just do scenes verbatim.
Sure.
And he's doing Lugosi, and we're like, holy shit, this is cool. And then Eddie goes, you guys ever heard of a comic named Rudy Ray Moore? And we go, oh, my God, and we look at each other.
Yeah, because you had the whole human tornado in your past.
Okay, that's what this meeting is all about. Yeah. All right.
And we're just, I mean, whatever. And I think he was expecting to have to, like,
explain
to who Rudy was. So the idea that he found the two writers he was thinking about happened to also be Rudy Ray Moore fanatics. It was kind of like a complete weird kismet thing that happened.
That is weird, yeah. That is very strange.
Yeah. And so we got so excited, and Rudy and Eddie, the next couple of days later, actually got us in the room with Rudy Ray Moore.
And to be clear, I mean, Rudy was a really important influence upon Eddie, and Eddie looked up to him, and a lot of guys from Eddie's generation saw the movies, listened to the albums, saw him many, many times in the clubs, and they knew each other.
You know, for every like comedy legend, there's the guy that guy or girl, a man or woman that inspired them that never like hit their level of fame. Like for Lenny Bruce, there was a guy named Joe Ancis who was like, oh yeah, Joe Ancis was the real Lenny Bruce. Lenny Bruce like took everything he knew from Joe Ancis, and that's really where Lenny Bruce came from.
I mean, what's the Velvet Underground quote? Only 1,000 people ever bought the albums, but all of them started a band.
All of them started a band, right? Yes. Yeah.
And I would say Rudy was
absolutely that sort of, and he is the godfather of rap. Snoop Dogg. Yeah.
Well, definitely that's the case. I mean, the early rappers really looked up to Rudy, and Snoop's in our movie simply because of the fact that, like, you know, he worshipped Rudy, he knew Rudy, but people like the Two Life Crew and Eazy-E, and even the ones who aren't necessarily the dirty rappers, just saw
because
the fact that
Rudy's albums were it's a lot of dozens and it's a lot of rhyme.
To a rhythm.
And it's the bravado. The bravado particularly the persona, that gangster rap had where like I can put a cap in your ass. Really what it is.
Yeah, no, it is, and I really there's so much of the music of language and what he does. And it is like music, even though it's not music.
You know? Well, there's a beautiful moment in the movie where it sort of goes from him doing a comedy routine to him doing a musical routine. And it's all simply done. It's not done in any kind of planning, anything that's supposed to happen. But I don't want to give too much of a away, but there's certainly just...
It happens live. It happens live. Seems spontaneous.
It's our film, but you get a little bit of a chill.
No, it's great.
It's an accidental thing that happens. It's like, oh my God, you're seeing rap kind of begin.
It's amazing.
And that whole segue was done really well by Craig Brewer.
Yeah, that was beautifully done by Craig.
And the music just sort of creeps into the scene.
Mm-hmm. And so Eddie Murphy comes to you 16 years ago, and you're going to...
All right, so then
we
meet with Rudy.
Now, where's Rudy at this point in his life? How did he, like... Did he have money?
He was living in Las Vegas. He was still doing shows. I mean, I'd seen him a couple years earlier at the Club Lingerie on Sunset.
Right. You know,
he was still traveling.
Bob Odenkirk, who's in the movie,
right,
was also a big Rudy Ray Moore fan. And I don't know if did he tell you about when he met with Rudy?
Because he'd written a script.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he wanted to do a script with Rudy Ray Moore too.
Yeah. Rudy did the whole bravado, which is like, well, it's about time someone made a movie about me because I'm so important.
Sure.
And I'm so influential, because Rudy, no one loves Rudy more than Rudy.
But I'm convinced that, when people go like, he's got it, people that are on screen and you just look at them and you can't tear your eyes off them. I think one of the things that goes into that is just pure self-love and narcissism.
Just total belief in yourself.
Rudy
has spent his entire life making things happen for himself because no one was going to make it.
Totally admire. Nothing wrong with that.
Absolutely, 100%.
Yeah. He has no shame about that body.
In that time period, Rudy, it's like Rudy's life never changed. He was just still the guy driving 4 hours every day to the next club and then setting up the merch table. and you know, and just living out of motels.
I wish I had no idea what that was like.
In a gold T-shirt.
I do fly. Scratchers. No, I do have merch, but I just sign posters.
In a gold ashtrays.
Drink koozies is that one people do.
What's that?
Beer koozies, those foam things you put your can of beer in.
Isn't that a cozy? Is that called a cozy?
Cozy koozie? I don't know. You know more. I am. Well, beer cozy.
Koozie sounds dirty.
Well, that's why. That's Rudy had a beer the way koozie. I sell.
So yeah, we hung out with Rudy, and Rudy told us his life story, and Rudy because of who he is, told us his life story in a way he thought it could be a movie. And
tell me about your life. Open on. No. I just want to know about your life.
Exactly. No, that's exactly right.
I mean, and this scene, I'm great.
We had a blast with him. It was great, and we promised him we'd, you know, he's going to make the movie, and then we went out to pitch it, and nobody cared. Like, we really couldn't be, you know, even with Eddie and us.
That's
getting a studio excited because
that's still, amazing.
Line, it was Rudy Ray Moore, and to most studio executives at that time, it was like, wait a second, this is some really obscure shit. They didn't know Rudy,
but you'd already made Man on the Moon.
Yeah, now
Larry
Flynt. That could be the problem.
I mean,
this is a few years after Man on the Moon, which did not make money, right. And so it is another comedian.
Right,
it's another comedian biopic. So,
no, but is it people don't understand? I get it, but it's just like the business. Like, you can have Eddie Murphy and famous screenwriters, and you walk in and just nope.
Yeah. It's a heartless.
I remember walking through.
Also, here's the weird thing. I mean, the language in the movie is so out there. As we're all talking about, it would be very easy to misunderstand the kind of film we wanted to make. When you end up seeing this movie, it is the sweetest movie.
The sweetest. Ever see, I agree, 100%.
They use MF 300 times.
Yes.
You know, but no one was really seeing that, even though we were pitching it that way.
Yes.
And so it just didn't happen. It didn't happen, and it killed us. It just went away, and a few years later after that, Rudy died, and we felt terrible. I even did a special tribute evening for him at the American Cinematheque, where I got the real Jerry Jones and the real Ben Taylor, the people who worked with him.
I told you, you should have gotten the fake Jerry Jones.
Exactly.
You got the real one.
Or Jenny Jones.
Exactly. They come down, we showed two of the movies, and we talked about, you know, how they got made and their relationship with Rudy. And I don't know, years went by, and we kept on hearing, like, someone was going to, you know, do a remake of Dolemite, or a couple of people actually were talking about doing Rudy's story, and, you know, we always thought we blew it, and someone else was going to do it.
Right.
And then, and we had kind of moved on, but every couple of years, someone would show up in our office, believing they had the rights to Rudy or the rights to remake Dolemite, and we never wanted to be attached to one of these other projects, but we certainly encourage people saying, we'll be the first ones in line to buy a ticket.
Right.
But it just never happened.
And then
a lot more years go by, and then after we did People versus OJ, we were, you know, it's like you're hot and you're cold and you're hot and you're cold, and now we're hot again for 5 minutes.
Exactly. We had that 1 month where you can go into a studio and people will, like, think your terrible ideas are good.
And we had a meeting with John Davis and John Fox, our producers, and started talking about this, and they've done a lot of movies with Eddie, and we thought, oh wow. And so John called up Eddie saying, as he says, the boys. I mean, we're in our mid-50s. We're still the boys.
Yeah, I know.
The boys are here, and they want to do that Dolemite thing. Are you still into it? And he said, yeah, fuck yeah, I am.
Yeah. And Eddie, but, you know,
Eddie had been a long time since he even made a movie.
Yeah, I mean, he made, like, a movie about, like, a chef. It was in Chicago.
But it was one of those things where he was sort of, like, not
semi-retired.
Yeah, exactly.
As Eddie says, he was just sitting on the couch.
Right.
And
is that what he says?
Yeah, he's very,
he likes sitting on the couch.
Open about that, and we got really excited because we miss Eddie Murphy.
Yeah.
And I mean, it's been 20 years since Eddie was R-rated. And
really?
Eddie.
He went through that same thing. And Robin, God rest his soul, did the same thing.
But that wasn't.
Yeah.
But he hasn't said fuck on screen since the 90s.
Since the 90s. But I would say, I mean, for me, Robin Williams, his strength wasn't about cursing. That's no, not, that's but, not but, what I associate
no,
with.
No, but he's he, but he's he made these, and I you know he. I don't know Eddie. I've met him, but I don't know. I knew Robin, and you know Robin's. You know, Robin could have played Dolemite. Robin could have played Rudy Ray Moore. I mean, Robin on stage and yeah. is profane.
But
in a fun way, it's a different energy.
I'm a civilian for him, so I don't think of him that way.
But what I meant was both of them went into family films.
Yeah,
yeah, but Eddie's.
With Patch Eddie Adams kid, and all that stuff.
You know, and
it's raw, it's delirious.
Raw, it's 48 hours.
Yeah, but, he was the new Richard Pryor.
And he's
doing Eddie Murphy. I'm not saying
that was the shtick at first. Like, oh, it's like a young Richard Pryor. This guy's amazing.
Yeah, a lot of nice.
But what I'm saying, they didn't say it was a young Bill Cosby. It was a young Richard Pryor. He was dirty and hilarious and delirious is. I mean, the first joke in Delirious is a wrecking ball.
Yeah.
The Honeymooners bit.
I mean, many of the friendly reviews about the movie have sort of welcomed back just that torrent of profane comedy.
Yeah, it's great.
Where it pours out of Eddie, and it's not even that he's being insulting or nasty with the profanity. It's just a vernacular that makes him that much funnier and that much freer.
It is. And it's like Richard Pryor, those Pryor albums. It's the musicality of it.
Yes.
Just,
yeah.
You know,
yes.
And we really miss that.
Yeah.
And so when we set up the project, we sort of felt like we can just write the greatest part for Eddie Murphy where it can just maximize everything he excels in, everything we've been missing for 20 years.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
he can swear and he can be musical, and then he can also be quiet and touching.
Yeah, and dramatic. He can
and
can,
introspective.
It combines the performance he gave in Dreamgirls with the rawness of his stand-up comedy.
Right, because he has he's matured as a man and an actor, and there's so much resonance in.
Yeah, strangely enough, we're writing this movie to be a tribute to Rudy Ray Moore, but it's also a tribute to Eddie Murphy.
Yeah.
We're almost trying to like Scott said, was just, you know, write the piece that you always in your mind imagine what would be the greatest Eddie Murphy movie.
Yeah, yeah. And it is true. And it's very, like there's so much humanity to Rudy. He imbues him with so much humanity. And I love the scenes where it's Eddie and Craig Robinson and
Mike Epps?
Yeah. And they're just sitting in a coffee shop talking about I could do this as an act. Because Dolemite, the character of Dolemite and the bits from Dolemite came from a wino, basically. Right.
But what is interesting, you're talking about it as an act. That's something we kind of didn't discuss.
But just seeing those guys talking, I felt like privy to, like, this is a world I was never a part of.
You're sort of a part of it in your stand-up comedy world, though. After some sets, you go out and have a cup of coffee. And
I mean, three African-American guys talking about how they're not represented in culture.
Yeah, yeah.
You know?
Yeah, yeah.
And
yeah, no, I mean, it's a nice joke because we like putting in obscure jokes that are just for the three people in this room.
That's pretty,
but then
pretty
the
close.
Joke could also make a point, which is Craig saying that he always keeps the morning after Love from Poseidon Adventure in his back pocket in case there's a white face in the audience.
Yeah, so
and Eddie going, they don't want to hear you sing that shit.
It's true. Yeah, it's very true. That was a nice. It's nice to see, you know, there have been very few Eddie Murphy, Maria Muldaur crossovers.
But what I was about to say is that the quiet scenes and the quiet moments. It actually came out of the initial meeting with Rudy, where we had never met Rudy Ray Moore, and we're expecting Dolemite.
We're expecting bluster,
and Dolemite did show up. He was definitely entertaining, but then when he stopped entertaining, he was a quiet, normal guy.
Yeah.
And I wouldn't say normal guy, but he was quiet.
Yeah.
He was quiet and reserved, and that's when we realized, wait a second, Dolemite is a mask that he puts on, and it almost like and as you're a comic, you know, a lot of comics do that, where like there's that quiet person who goes home and takes care of the kids and does all that stuff, but then they come out and they're like all of a sudden
Robin
is a great example of that, and so we thought, well, that's the key to our film. is that, and that's why a movie's called Dolemite Is My Name, because it's about someone who takes on this persona and becomes known.
And he had other personas before that.
Yes, he did. Harlem Hillbilly.
And Prince Dumar.
And Prince Dumar, right. That was the other one that I couldn't think of. I'm a big Screamin' Jay Hawkins fan. And he's another guy that, you know, found a persona and had to wear it.
But I only know the persona.
Yeah.
If there's a real Screamin' Jay, I never.
He was a maniac. But I've read his biographies. And okay. I've been a fan for him a long time.
And you might have 60 kids.
And you know, not a great dad, not a very responsible human being.
Your dad's first name is Screaming. His first name is, yeah. I mean, a lot of us had screaming dads, but
I went to his
driver's license.
Yeah. What was it like at a party? Screaming? Do you know lightning? Lightning screaming. Screaming? Do you know howling? Come here, me screaming and lightning. He would feel like fucking skull on a stick. I gotta get in the fucking coffin. Yeah. Like, you know, he was talked into doing the thing where they carried him on stage in a coffin, and then that became a shtick.
Right.
And it became like Pete Townsend smashing guitars. Like, yeah, all right, where's the guitar? You know, and you become a prisoner of this thing. And it's something that you put on, you know, that Dolemite carried Rudy Ray Moore through his life. Dolemite paid for Rudy Ray Moore's life.
Absolutely.
So, you know, you got to give back to the
man. Someone just tell us the story. They hired him to perform at a wedding.
Wait, someone did say that. Yeah, I forget who it was.
It was utterly bizarre. They thought it would be, they were a big fan. They thought it would be a good idea.
I think Odenkirk had him perform someplace.
I mean, we have one Odenkirk story. I mean, Odenkirk's not billed in the movie, so it's already been spoiled.
You weren't supposed to say it.
I'll cut that reference. No, that's totally fine.
Whatever. They're going to.
Oh, you said it again.
Bill Odenkirk, the Simpsons writer.
We both separately were at different like banquets. I was at an awards banquet, and Scott was at the Writers Guild.
I was at the Writers Guild poker fundraiser,
and we both ran into Odenkirk, and he found out that we were working on the Rudy Ray Moore story, and he was just like, "I'll play any part. You're gonna need some white guy to be not
you need
get
a white
joke.
Guy.
You yeah. want some guy to be like, you know, the bar manager who throws him out. Whatever you need. Yeah. I'll play any single part.
Yeah, and, yeah. He's a big.
You know,
fan.
He was just.
Yeah.
I'm such a fan. I don't care. I'll drop whatever I'm doing. I'll come. Don't worry about whatever. I'll be there.
Right. Yeah. No, that's,
and
that's,
he really is. He's almost the only Caucasian in the film.
Yeah. Yeah. No, he's great. And he's. Yeah. He's
we got the four Bahari brothers.
Mm-hmm.
But that's a great, you know, the Bahari brothers who basically own the record company, right? That made, what I loved about them is they're not cartoony, or they could have easily been cartoons.
Yes,
and they're not, and they seem to really support Rudy and believe in Rudy.
Yeah, you keep waiting for them to try to rip him off
and they never do.
And that's the beauty. But that's the beauty. That's what I love about the movie is like. You set up these things and then, no, we're not doing that.
Yeah.
We're not telling that joke.
Yeah.
It's great.
Well, it's a rare movie that it doesn't have a villain. But, you know, the villain.
Yeah, the villain is Wesley Snipes.
The villain is a traditional show business.
Yeah.
You know, or the people who aren't.
The villain is the system.
Yeah.
The villain is
society.
The villain is Jack Lemmon and Walter Matthau.
Absolutely, 100%.
Freaking Jack Lemmon.
As in most movies, the villain is Jack Lemmon.
To quote Pauline Kael, what does he want from us?
But so many film nerds have come up to us just from seeing the trailer saying, do you have against the front page? It's Billy Wilder. And it's like, we technically have nothing against the front page. Yeah. I don't think that's
what
we're
No, stop defending
not,
it.
Yeah, it's not a good film. But that's not the point of that scene. The point is, it's about representation. It's about, like, you know, you whatever. Everyone thinks, oh, that's a really funny movie. And when you pan in the audience and you see all the people laughing at it, and you get to that row of Rudy's friends – you realize that they don't see themselves.
Yeah, they're not in
American
America.
Culture. And
right,
it's a gaping hole that they see. That
yeah, the front page in Dolemite is the movie that inspires.
Yeah.
Dolemite to write a movie, to make a movie. Yeah.
It's like I gotta get up in that light.
There's another great example of like when you know a lack of representation that at the time you fully don't realize is going on.
Yeah.
And it's Margaret Cho has the one of my favorite jokes of all time about the show Kung Fu.
Okay.
That starred David Carradine.
Absolutely.
As Kwai Chang Kane. And she said the title of that show should have been, "Hey, that guy's not Chinese." Which is so true. It's a, and it never occurred to me. It's like, oh, yeah, he's not Chinese. It was really Bruce Lee was going to be Kane.
Yeah. No, really?
Oh, yeah.
No.
That broke Bruce Lee's heart. That it was all meant to be Bruce Lee. And they were like, no, he doesn't. His TVQ wasn't high enough.
He was too Chinesey to play a Chinese guy. Yeah. No, it's just
that's why that's why he wound up with Raymond Chow. He left Hollywood and said, "Fuck it, I'm going back."
Yeah. And it is one of those things where, you know, like I remember Kung Fu and
I remember being even for myself, I love Kung Fu and I love the show and I love David Carradine, but even in South Bend, Indiana, I was like, he's not Chinese. How's that?
Yeah, it's Chinese guy? But it's
I
a great
I watched Kung Fu because I always sensed that there was something off.
Well, here's the thing. At the beginning of every Kung Fu, there'd be a quiz. And it would be, you're going to meet some characters, and you're going to find out which character Kane is going to beat up at the act break. Usually, it was a choice between the singing nun and the guy who kept the mentally retarded kid in a bag. It was one of those two, and you weren't sure which. It was like the $6 million man running, all the fights were in slow motion.
All the fights were in slow motion. Yeah, that was a little drag.
But it's a beautiful scene where Dolemite and his friends are sitting in the audience, and they're watching this movie, and they're from outer.
Just out of space. For fun trivia for anyone who would be listening to Dana Gould's podcast.
Yeah, it's
in our script. It was A Touch of Class,
right?
And it was going to be Glenda Jackson and George Segal,
right,
doing middle aged flirting with each other, and we thought this is the whitest film ever made. And what's great is it was a giant hit. It's an
nominated
Oscar,
best picture.
Nominated
basically
best picture.
Forgotten.
It won an Oscar, and it's utterly forgotten, and nobody in the last 30 years has seen this movie. So it was perfection for us. And in all of our early drafts, it is Touch of Class, and it's the guys mumbling about who is that woman and this ain't funny and all that kind of stuff. And then at the last second, Touch of Class was made by Brute, which was a shampoo company. George Berry's hair care company. And
it was a cologne. Was it B-R-U-T?
I know he did shampoo.
Right. Yeah. I mean, there was a cologne called Brute, but I'm not sure that it was done by the Brute Corporation.
Okay. Because Joe Namath had those commercials.
Yeah.
I like
Brute.
It might be, actually.
And George Berry got I think that's his name. George Berry got bored with making shampoo, so he made movies, and he actually co-wrote the song A Touch of Class. He actually won an Oscar.
it was nominated, did not win.
I thought it won.
Of all the shampoo financed movies, this was the biggest hit.
Yeah, they made a lot of movies.
So when we went
Whiffs.
To
shampoo, obviously.
And what's the Elizabeth Taylor, Lawrence Harvey?
Holy shit!
Ash Wednesday, not Ash Wednesday.
Night Watch. I think that was Brute.
Yeah.
So when they went to clear it, the right.
What was what movie did Lawrence Harvey?
Blood Beach.
Thank you.
He doesn't have to finish the question.
Yeah, I know. I know, it's really great.
Dana Gould will bring up Lawrence Harvey. Blood Beach.
Yeah. So as I accidentally said, the rights to the shampoo film were tangled.
Yeah.
So we couldn't clear it, and at the last second, this is like a few weeks out. We get told that Universal is willing to play ball.
Right.
The Universal will give us anything. So Larry and I quickly went through 73, 74, 75, like what works? Oh, the front page.
Right.
That's a very white movie.
Right.
And we can see
that
movie.
And bogus 1970s nostalgia for the Roaring 20s. The Roaring 20s, the Sting,
right.
And all those movies.
So we can see that movie.
And which
not
was
speaking.
Huge.
Oh, gigantic.
Yeah. Gatsby and...
Yeah.
Oh,
they shoot horses, don't they?
Lucky Lady.
Wow.
Yeah.
Nickelodeon.
Harry Walter, Go to New York. Oh, these movies are like, wow.
Yeah.
I defy anyone to watch.
Wanton-ton.
Wanton-ton. Wow. And you could put Daisy.
Daisy Miller.
Daisy Miller.
Daisy Miller.
Kind of, sort of, yes.
The 30s?
Yeah.
At Long Last Love.
At Long Last Love is the one I was thinking of.
That would have been a great thing for Rudy.
We should have done that.
That was the one I was thinking of. That's Burt Reynolds and Civil Shepherd, Peter Bogdanovich. That's the one I was thinking of.
Alan Khan's good.
Yeah.
Well, no, there's that one extended like 6-minute tracking shot
where
she sings. It's nice. So anyway, we quickly settle on Was there another Universal title we were toying with?
Not really. It became the front page. I think someone was at one point talking about the girl from Petroika. Whatever.
That was too obscure.
Too obscure. Mm-hmm. We weren't trying to go for obscure. We were just trying to say, well, and also there was a Christmas scene, and the front page was actually Universal's Christmas.
It was a Christmas release.
Right. And whatever. It seemed perfect.
Well, yeah, it's so funny. You have a scene in the movie that is not in the movie, but you're telling me about, is it a Universal screen room and they're complaining about the Jaws overruns?
Yes.
Yeah.
Because the big movie for Universal that year was the Hindenburg.
Yeah. Yes. We tried to get all our dates right. So we had a 3-4 page run in the middle of the script that got, we shot it. It just got cut out because the movie was a little long, where people react to the finished Dolemite movie. And so we wanted to see a bunch of Universal suits screening it with their jaws agape, just confused what they're watching. But because Larry and I like pre-scenes more than scenes, we had the execs walking down the hallway bitching about the overruns on Jaws.
That's great.
And Zanuck keeps telling me they're going to wrap in the next 2 weeks, but I don't believe him. And why'd we ever – we should have shot in the tank.
Oh, that's so great.
You know, so it's that shtick. And that's stuff so makes great. Us happy.
Yeah.
Yeah,
but we totally understood when it got cut.
Yeah, sure.
You can't defend it.
So the film is done, and this movie has sort of brought Eddie Murphy back into making movies. He's now
doing Coming to America with Craig Brewer, our director. Right? I mean, what happened was the
Coming to America 2. They're not remaking the original.
Coming to America.
Oh, smart.
Coming to America. Wait, get what? It? So coming to
the America. Entire movie is a salute to homonyms.
Coming to America 2?
Coming to America.
Coming, the numeral two.
Really?
Yeah.
As opposed to the word two.
Oh. Okay.
Homonyms, my friend.
I think everyone had such a great time on the set, and Craig did such a great job of directing. And it's like, whatever, we'd love to make another movie with Craig. Craig is just such a great person.
And tell people about for other movies that he made, Hustle and Flow,
Black Snake Moan. He's just a smart, really good guy, can really direct actors, can really direct music. I think Eddie was so just amped up at the end of this, and they had been talking about doing Coming to America for a long time.
Yeah,
the
script's been around for a while.
I mean, I'll compare Craig to Rudy in that Craig is really supportive of everyone.
Yeah.
And he gets the best out of everyone because he makes them feel really good about the job they're doing.
That's so key, and so it's such a simple thing. Which is probably why it's so elusive.
Yeah, correct.
You know, it's just like, just make people feel good about themselves. Make people want to come to work.
Yeah. And people here came to work. I mean, you'd come to work even if you weren't needed at work.
Yeah.
People would just hang out on the set because it was like, oh my God, Eddie and Chris Rock are going to be a scene today. Yeah. Why would I miss that?
Yeah.
You know.
It's great. Well, the people really, as I said, it's so funny. But it's also, it's so sweet, and the bit in the movie that seems like the convention that you put in, like somebody watched this movie and would think like it's a true story, and then clearly that thing at the end wasn't true, but it was sweet. No, the thing at the end is true.
Absolutely, 100%. There's a big premiere, and actually, in all fairness,
oh, you're going to give it away.
I'll give it away, but whatever. Oh. It's Ed Wood.
Wait, don't listen, people.
In Ed Wood, we had to lie, in a sense.
Yes,
that Pantages premiere for Ed Wood is all in Ed Wood's mind, and it's all a projection of future.
Yeah,
what the future will hold for that will be the movie he will be remembered for.
Right.
When Rudy premiered Dolemite in Chicago at the Woods Theater, it was madness, and there were so many shows that basically had to add 2 a.m. shows, late shows, and Rudy didn't want people to be disappointed waiting in line, and he sat there and performed all night for the people out in line.
That's amazing.
And so when we heard about that, it's like that has to be the end of the
night. It is amazing. It's so great.
Now they know the ending.
If anyone out there is disappointed by the end of the movie because you learned about the Woods Theater on this podcast, I'll gladly reimburse your money. It's on, free, it's on Netflix. Never mind. Forget
it's free.
It. It's free. I'll ruin everything out of it. I know it's free.
And you're writing another movie now.
I tell them the end of The Irishman.
Yeah, we don't want to talk about it.
They find out at the end of The Irishman why they're always after me, Lucky Charms.
Mm. That's a fine time.
That joke is lame enough to end on.
every one of you watching this screen, look out. Because soon, very soon, the most horrifying monster menace ever conceived will be oozing into this theater. Two teenagers see it first, like a falling star from outer space.
Boy, that was close. Hey, come on, I want to see if I can find it.
It's indestructible. It's indescribable. Nothing can stop it.
This town is in danger.
How can it be stopped? Mob hysteria sweeps one city. Before long, the nation and then the world could fall before the blood-curdling threat of the Bob.
Starring Steve McQueen and a cast of exciting young people.
He was one of the most popular and successful film directors in the world, and he was at the peak of his career and his power. In the past 10 years, he had directed the following films: Stage Fright, Strangers on a Train, I Confess, Dial M for Murder, Rear Window, To Catch a Thief, The Trouble with Harry, The Man Who Knew Too Much, The Wrong Man, Vertigo, and he had just wrapped North by Northwest with Cary Grant and Eva Marie Saint. And that wasn't his entire career. That was the last 10 years. It was then that Alfred Hitchcock, British by birth, but living in Hollywood since 1939, when David O. Selznick brought him over to direct Rebecca, began to plot his next movie. Although at the top of his game, Hitchcock was very restless, constantly looking for ways to challenge both himself and his audience. He had recently dismissed the just-completed film North by Northwest as a Technicolor bauble. Now, granted, this was MGM's biggest budgeted film of the year after Ben-Hur, and it would go on to become one of Hitchcock's biggest hits. But he felt he needed to recharge his batteries, to challenge himself. He was admirably aware of the dangers of repeating himself. And this was not unusual for Alfred Hitchcock. H.N. Swanson, who was a friend of his, as well as being Raymond Chandler and Elmore Leonard's agent, said Hitchcock never casually looked for something different. He was relentless. Michael Ludmer, whose job was to find material for Alfred Hitchcock, said, "We scoured everything, plays, novels, short stories, newspaper clippings. Whodunits were out of the question. He mistrusted science fiction, the supernatural, or anything to do with professional criminals. Since one couldn't second guess what little spark might turn him on, it was terribly backbreaking tracking material for him." He had come close to two projects and had spent a small fortune prepping them. Flamingo Feather was a diamond heist caper set in Africa. Hitchcock even went to Africa to scout locations, but the script never came together and the project was abandoned. After that, a dark comedy based on a murder, No Bail for the Judge, about a judge who is accused of murdering a prostitute and is defended by his own daughter. The script was great, written by Samuel Taylor, who had written Vertigo, which is a masterpiece. And Audrey Hepburn was all set to star. Everything looked great. Unfortunately, Audrey Hepburn announced she was pregnant, left the project, and it too fell apart. Something else was eating at Alfred Hitchcock. And that was filmmakers who had, quote, pulled a Hitchcock, creating Hitchcockian thrillers at a fraction of his budget and raking in massive profits. The film that really stuck in his craw was a French thriller called La Diabolique, made in 1955 by Henri-Georges Clouzot. La Diabolique tells the story of a murder plot gone wrong, with a surprise shocker ending that had critics hailing Clouzot as the Gallic Hitchcock. La Diabolique was remade in the 90s with Sharon Stone. Don't see that version. But you should definitely see the original from 1955. Now, Diabolique was shot on a modest budget in black and white with no major stars, and it made a fortune. Hitchcock thought, quite rightly, that he could do the same thing, only better. All he needed was the right material. In addition to Michael Ludmer, one of the other people responsible for tracking material for Alfred Hitchcock was a woman named Peggy Robertson. And Peggy Robertson had recently read the studio coverage of a novel called Psycho by a little-known writer from Milwaukee named Robert Block. Now, coverage of a book. You see, film studios pay people to read current books, magazines, newspaper articles, etc., and then write up a summation of them, along with the reader's review of the material, specific to its potential as a movie. That way, all of the executives don't have to read everything that comes in over the transom. This is called coverage. And the coverage of Robert Block's Psycho read, "Pass, impossible for film." But Peggy Robertson ignored the coverage and saw something that the reader didn't see, and she passed it on to her boss. Now, according to Stephen Rebello's excellent book, Alfred Hitchcock and the Making of Psycho, from which most of this material comes, the director's review was, with his typical understatement, "I think the thing that appealed to me and made me decide to do the picture was the suddenness of the murder in the shower, coming as it were out of the blue. And that was about all. What the truth was, well, your guess is as good as mine." Alfred Hitchcock certainly was not about to say it. Alfred Hitchcock's current deal was with Paramount Pictures, and it was to Paramount that he pitched Psycho. He pitched the story. Now, you have to understand, he is coming off the soon-to-be-released grand spectacle of North by Northwest, with Cary Grant in the lead, being chased through a cornfield by an airplane, wooing Eva Marie Saint on a train car. And Psycho seemed a radical departure, a seamy little tale of seamy little people in seamy small surroundings. Remember, most of the action takes place at an out-of-the-way roadside motel. A petty robbery motivates the action, but still, this was Hitchcock at the height of his career. Paramount hated it. Hated it. They didn't like one thing about it. They tried to dissuade Hitchcock from making it, but he had his heart set on it. Instead, they politely informed their star director that he would not, in any way, be getting his normal budget. He smiled politely and excused himself from the meeting. Now, at this time, it's important to remember that during this period, Hitchcock also had a TV series, Alfred Hitchcock Presents, a weekly half-hour murder mystery anthology. He introduced each episode, directed a couple episodes each season. There was also Alfred Hitchcock's Mystery Magazine, a Reader's Digest-like magazine, ostensibly edited by Hitchcock, but he had nothing to do with it. But the point is, the guy was popular. So, smarting from his meeting with the suits at Paramount, Hitchcock set about on a solution. He would plan Psycho as carefully as he did any of his other features, but he would shoot it fast, dirty, and quick, like one of his TV series episodes. He would even shoot it with his TV crew, in black and white. He went back to Paramount's executive offices with this plan, expecting them to appreciate the fact that, although he disagreed with their assessment of his new project, at least he was willing to compromise and play ball. So Hitchcock went back and repitched his idea. The Paramount executive said, "Okay, great, only we're not going to pay for it, and you can't shoot it on the lot," which was really shitty because they made money off renting out the lot, and the lot was available. They wanted nothing to do with this project. It was a spiteful move, but they didn't say the word no. This in show business is called a soft pass, a no that sounds like a yes. "Would you like to go out to dinner?" "I'd love to. How about February 30th? But Hitchcock was ready this time. He offered to finance the film himself, and he would shoot it at Universal. In exchange, he would defer his rather hefty director's fee for 60% ownership of the negative. Now, in Paramount's opinion, 60% of nothing was nothing. So they agreed to the deal. They shouldn't have. They should have seen, in Hitchcock's insistence, that he knew something they didn't. That he had something in mind, that he had something up his sleeve. The guy's a genius. He knew something they didn't, unfortunately, and this is a lesson they would learn the hard way. The idea that someone knew something they didn't was not an idea they entertained often. After a couple of false starts, Hitchcock settled on a writer named Joseph Stefano to write the script. A key change from Bloch's book was the character of Norman Bates. In the novel, Norman is very much patterned after his real-life inspiration, Wisconsin serial killer Ed Gein. In the book, Norman is a burly, lonely, withdrawn, 40-odd-year-old alcoholic dude. Joseph Stefano felt, quite rightly, that such a depiction prevented the audience from sympathizing with Norman, as well as removing any sense of surprise that would be derived from his actions. You know, Darth Vader shows up and you know he's going to be shitty. Stefano was right. Hitchcock said, what if Norman was played by somebody like Anthony Perkins? Now, at the time, Anthony Perkins was a smooth-skinned, soft-spoken, teen heartthrob of an actor. No pun intended. He was kind of a, you know, mama's boy.
Do you go out with friends?
Well, a boy's best friend is his mother.
Stefano lit up. Anthony Perkins as Norman would be a surprise, which was what this movie, to Hitchcock, was all about. Additionally, they would start the movie with the character of Marion Crane, played in the film by Janet Leigh, who was a big star at the time. Therefore, Psycho, in the audience's mind, would be Marion Crane's story. And then, halfway through the story, they'd kill her. Out of the blue, in a way that no one would forget. No discussion of Psycho would be complete without some commentary on the shower scene, so let's get to it. The most famous scene in the movie, one of the most famous scenes in movie history. The most amazing thing about the scene is what it does to the story. It kills the star of the picture halfway through, stranding the audience in the narrative, literally forcing them to join the hunt for Marion's killer so they can finish the story. It interrupts the movie as violently as it interrupts the lives of Marion, her friends, and her family. Technically, the scene took over a week to shoot and required 77 different camera angles. The final sequence runs 3 minutes and includes 50 cuts, no pun intended. The scene is so famous, it has emerged with its own surrounding mythology. The biggest controversy being that the scene was not directed by Alfred Hitchcock, but instead by Saul Bass, who storyboarded the sequence and designed the film's titles. Saul Bass's claim that he actually directed the sequence has been refuted by everyone on Earth, with the exception of Saul Bass. Other questions? Was that always Janet Leigh in the shower, naked? No. There was a body double there named Marley Renfro who did all of the nakedness. Do you see any illicit nudity by 1960 standards? No. But the piece is cut in such a way that you are sure you have. Same with the stabbing. You don't see any, although you are sure that you do. Psycho was released in the summer of 1960 and was a huge, huge, huge success. So much so, it caught Hitchcock and Paramount, who by now were ruefully regretting their short-sightedness, totally by surprise. The film cost less than $1 million to make and grossed $32 million at the box office. Coming in second that year only to, can you guess? No, you can't. Disney's Swiss Family Robinson. With his deal, having financed the film himself, Alfred Hitchcock was now wealthier than he could ever imagine. And that year, at the Academy Awards, Alfred Hitchcock was, as usual, completely shut out.
Good afternoon. Here we have a quiet little motel, tucked away off the main highway, and as you see, perfectly harmless looking, when in fact, it has now become known as the scene of the crime.
Tonight, White Horse Drive-In Theater, The Trial of the Dead. 18 living nightmares leap from the stage. All lights go out and the monsters are released from their coffins. They may grab you. Victims from the audience will be thrown from the stage a piece at a time. Human heads chopped off. Jungle worms and swamp rats run around your feet. Extra on stage, back from the grave. The spirit materialization of Bruce Lee, King of Kung Fu. It's real. On stage, not a movie. You may need help. Help! Help! Tonight, White Horse Drive-In Theater.
And we are joined on this, it's getting to be autumn. It's chilly in the morning and then coasting up to the mid-90s. Actor, writer, raconteur.
Writer?
Sure.
What have I written?
You were an improvising actor.
Okay, fine. Yes.
You get the point.
Contributor.
Jeffrey Combs.
I am thrilled to be with you, Dana.
So you know a lot about Edgar Allan Poe.
Some. I'm not a historian
right
at all.
But you know a lot about it. You know a lot about H.P. Lovecraft.
I'm not.
More than the average person.
More than the average right. Joe. Yeah.
You know a lot about Stuart Gordon.
More about that than other things.
Who's the weirdest?
I don't know if Stu is weird more than he is dogged.
Uh-huh.
I've never met anybody as just fortitude when it comes to his vision.
Yeah. And what people don't realize, I mean, people think of when you think of Stuart Gordon, they think of, you know, the films he made, but he came out of experimental theater. He came out of...
he got kicked out of college.
For a play with nudity in it, wasn't it?
He did Peter Pan, a nude.
Yeah, a nude Peter Pan.
And he decided that all of the, lost boys would be like little children.
Uh-huh.
So there were a lot of, he didn't tell anybody.
A lot of kids and adult nudity.
A lot of kids nude.
Yeah.
This is the dawning of the age of pedophilia.
No, right, yeah. No, it's still nude kids.
No, he just had a vision and they didn't go along with that.
Yeah. No, but it is funny how where he ended up in the films he made, it is a natural progression.
It is.
Of knowing what people want and then sliding the message into it.
Or just going farther than they thought they wanted. Yeah. He has a motto, you've heard, actors, less is more. Well, his motto is more is more.
More is more. More is more, but you've got to go all the way. But you're most known as Dr. Herbert West in Re-Animator. Mm-hmm. And, Re-Animator is gory, et cetera. Clearly made by very smart people. That is not...
That's not by accident.
Yeah,
there were some happy accidents.
Right, but sure. Re-Animator is not a slasher film. Re-Animator is not corpse porn. It's a real goddamn movie.
It is, and it has something to say. And it is. Stu is a loves to shock. I think he likes to break that psychic fourth wall, not just visually, but also. If you notice in a lot of his movies, there comes a point where you're engrossed in the movie and then suddenly you say to yourself, I can't believe I'm watching.
Yeah, well, this. I was showing it to Kat, my girlfriend, last night who'd never seen it. And the love scene.
The head giving head.
Yeah.
We call it the head giving head.
Yeah, no, that was exactly what she said. She's like, are we really watching this?
Mm-hmm. Not in the original Lovecraft story. I just
want to point that out. Was that in the script or was that on the stage?
Oh, that was in the script. Oh, that was in the script.
And again, Barbara Crampton, quite a sport.
Brave.
And the actor who was the instructor.
David Gale.
David Gale, right. I believed that you created a serum that reanimated the dead. Didn't buy his hairpiece.
You know why he had a hairpiece.
I can cut this.
He didn't need a hairpiece.
If he's a friend,
David did not need a hairpiece.
Oh, really?
Not at all. He had a full head of hair. But the problem is that that full head of hair would not match the fake wig that was on the fake decapitated.
Oh, I see. Head. I get you.
So that hairpiece was a solution so that there would be a match. Not because
I get it. Because I've seen him in other stuff. He did a ton of like Hill Street Blues. He was the
did
mayor.
He?
Yeah. Well, I mean, he's one of those guys. Like, oh yeah,
sweet
him.
Guy. You
yeah,
know?
Sure. Charlton Heston, when he did A Man for All Seasons at the Mark Taper Forum in the 70s.
Yes, I remember that.
He wore a bald cap over his toupee at the end of the play.
Because, God forbid, it should just be his bald head. Shatner should try that.
Well, Shatner, in the episode, in the original series Star Trek episode, that's the something years where they all become old.
Yes.
That's his real hair when he's old.
Really?
Yes.
I got to look at that.
Yeah. And there's also footage of like Connery at the premiere of You Only Live Twice.
And he's...
He doesn't have his toupee on. But I mean, he had hair. He had hair. He just didn't have enough.
It was just kind of on its way. I mean, yeah. You look back in movies.
And now it's cool to not have hair.
Yeah, I guess. It's not so cool. I hate losing my hair. Despise it.
You still got enough.
No, barely.
But you have what I'm going to have. You're only a couple years older
hideous.
Than me.
I feel like Samson losing my strength.
Well, look at the Fast and Furious franchise. The lead actors in those movies, they're all
bald.
Yeah. Well, they look like penises. That's my theory on that movie.
That's right.
It's you have to look like a boner to get cast in the film.
You look at the greats like Fonda, Stewart, John Wayne. They were all wearing toupees.
Oh, really? I didn't know that.
Oh, you know, just look at it later on. And I mean, John Wayne had a really bad one.
Yeah.
Near the end. But yeah, they were
on McClintock.
You're just not aware of it because you're just accepting the image. But
right.
if you look at it, you go, okay.
Oh, sure. Yeah, they're all wearing
sure,
rugs.
I get it.
Yeah.
Okay, sure.
Yeah. Sinatra had one of the all-time bad rugs.
Well, it was an era of not very good rugs. And we're talking about toupees. I never would have thought that.
Well, that's the beauty of the show. We go with the river.
Sean, you know, Sean Curry, he doesn't care.
And he doesn't.
There was a point where he said, fuck it.
And that's a beautiful thing. You just take it off and put it on. People don't care.
I like the Billy Bob Thornton.
Yeah.
And, you know, if the character needs it, get the best one you can.
Yeah.
And if it doesn't need it, then no problem.
Yeah, no problem at all. So just to do a little bit of a background for people uninitiated, and then I want to talk about your show. You're from Lompoc, California.
It's an Indian name.
Lompoc
kind of means basically like lagoon.
Oh, really?
In Chumash.
Would not have known. Lompoc. And where is Lompoc?
It is less than an hour north of Santa Barbara.
Okay. And midway to San Francisco, kind of, or inland?
Yeah, a little closer to L.A. than San Francisco.
Oh, it's down. Okay.
It's called the Central Coast. There's a huge Air Force base there, the largest one on the West Coast. My dad was a civil servant and worked there, so that's why I grew up there. Small town.
You must be the pride of Lompoc.
Well, I don't know. I mean, there have been some football players that have come from Lompoc. And
Re-Animator was your first. That was the thing that put you on the map.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I've been doing a lot of theater, and then I finally moved to L.A. and I was doing like, you know, day player on like some movies.
Right. Your first movie is that weird
Honky Tonk Freeway.
Honky Tonk Freeway, which is sort of a famous movie in its own way.
It is.
Like up until I think Heaven's Gate was one of the biggest. It was a ginormous
budget
tank. Yeah. And it lost a ginormous amount of money.
It was sort of a,
I don't blame you,
abject lesson in my initiation into film. I played I had one scene with Beverly D'Angelo. Mm-hmm. I was a bank teller, and it was one of those, I'm behind the glass and she's using one of those tubes, those vacuum tubes that shook into. Yeah. And then she's withdrawing her money. And so here I am in there, and they go, okay, here are your props. And they laid out in front of me, Dana, thousands of dollars. Real dollars.
Really?
And I'm going, Okay.
Much more than you're getting paid.
And it was shot in, I want to say, Chatsworth, Northridge, some little bank that had one of those
right.
vacuum tube things. And in the script, it was wintertime. But in reality, it was like summer.
Right.
They brought in frickin' trees with no leaves on them on plywood.
Really? And
set them out all over the place to sort of show that it was somewhere else in the South in winter. And I'm just marveling at the money that they were spending. And then guess what? In the scene, you never see.
You never see. It came out in late 70s?
79, 80.
So, yeah. The weird thing about Honky Tonk Freeway, it was a part of that late 70s CB craze, The Great Smoky Roadblock, which stars Henry Fonda, Convoy, Trucking.
Yeah, wherever there's a guy getting beat up, I'll be there. Yeah, this kind of, was it a continuation of like Mad World kind of thing?
Yeah, well, it was like a trucker thing, and it came out right as that craze kind of died.
Hmm.
And it was just, you know, it was all those like Saturday Night Fever and there was all those.
Yeah.
Thank God it's Friday and all Roller these Boogie
permutations. And, of yeah, the yeah. Same
and thing. It's just when you write a movie to crash in on a fad,
you're behind the curve.
Yeah, yeah.
But it was John Schlesinger directing. The great John Schlesinger, who was a sweet man and very kind to me. And two things about John Schlesinger. First of all, I went to ADR some months later. You know, mm-hmm. looping. And he said, can I talk to you for a second, Jeffrey? And so we sat down on this bench outside, and he said, I just wanted you to know that I had to cut this scene down in terms of time. It had nothing to do with you, but it was something that I had to do, and I hope you understand. I thought, wow, people are really kind in the...
wow, yeah, that's amazing.
But no, he was the gentleman. He was a gentleman, and he was sweet. And so that was
that's
very,
lovely.
That was and a lovely thing.
Yeah. Frank Darabont.
Yes.
Same guy. He called me up once. Really good job on ADR. And it was just me going like, and I got shot in a thing called Mob City.
However.
I didn't need to do that, did it?
And,
a gentleman.
And about six that's months how, later.
By the way, that's how you do it.
That's how you do it. Six months later, I get a random call from my agents, and they say, John Schlesinger called his office, and he wanted to know if you, he'll pay you some money if you would come to his office. He is directing for the National Theatre in London, True West, Sam Shepard's mm-hmm. True West, and he would like to lay down a reading of the play with some actors who he thinks their dialects are good for the English actors to hear that ear, hear that. And I was really like out of nowhere, he picks me to do that.
Yeah, that's great.
And I thought that was really sweet.
The natural state of an actor is insecurity. And
to have that
affirmation that, no, you're good. Come on in, you're good.
Yeah, really. No, I remember you. Yeah,
yeah.
You did that to me out of nowhere. You asked me to do Stand Against Evil.
Oh yeah, no, we were for the and the 30 people that watched Stand Against Evil have not forgotten.
I think it's more than that.
Yeah, no, Stand Against Evil has had a great
proud of that. I was really I great loved afterlife. That show. Well, I got such a kick out of that show.
That was really fun. It was one of those as I've quoted this a lot. Andy Kindler often says, "My target audience is men my age who are me." Yeah, this is, but it was like Re-Animator. It was like, I love horror movies, but I'm also funny and I want to be able to do it right. Yeah,
it was super great. It had a tone about it.
Well,
yeah, well.
But speaking of like times when you things that you do and you come back, there's an addition to, you know, Re-Animator, which sort of, when Re-Animator comes out, it's sort of one of the high points of the 80s horror movie.
Yeah.
Sort of boom.
Locked me into a whole other. Oh, right. That's what you do.
Right. Right. But that's great because you need a
brand. I need something.
That was your brand.
Got me on the dance floor.
Yeah, got you on the dance floor. And what were the offers that started to come in after Re-Animator? Because it was a while before Bride of Re-Animator.
I'm here to tell you, none.
Really? Mm-hmm. Because I saw it when it came out. And you could, and Roger Ebert, I remember seeing it. Roger Ebert loved it.
I think, yes, he did.
And he gave you specifically good notices.
He was very, very kind. I feel this way. We were the bad boys. We were the forbidden fruit.
Uh-huh.
We did not go through the studio. We were this quirky fringe kind of hit that the big studios just either it wasn't couldn't on their radar out, yeah. or they just couldn't figure out how that happened.
Right.
The movie came out unrated, which gave it a bit of a stigma for a lot of people.
Uh-huh.
And I have to say, because of the what happens in this movie and the head giving head and all of that sort of thing, that there was a bit of a backlash in the industry, I believe.
Really?
It was looked down upon. Now, I want you to point out to you that in those days, most casting directors were women.
Uh-huh.
Do you think that they're going to...
Right, and for the people who haven't seen it, you should just stop the podcast now
yeah.
and watch it.
Yeah.
And it's also like, again, you look back on it today... And you think like people would be jaded from it. No, it's still like, I showed it to Cal last night.
Oh my God. Yeah,
and what happens is a guy is beheaded, but his body and his head are still going. And
he lusts after
this woman and is able to, for the best of his ability, consummate that lust.
He's relentless in his pursuit.
Relentless in his pursuit. But again, you know, I put that scene on par with the sword fight from Monty Python and the Holy Grail. It knows how far over the line to go to be ridiculous.
I talked to Brian Yuzna, who produced it and was uh-huh. integral in like, what do we keep in and what do we take out? He said, actually, there was more shot and we cut it back.
No, you've got to know where the line
even
is.
Even though it's unrated, there's only so much. I'm just proud that I'm the Dudley Do-Right. I'm the guy who comes in and goes, let's stop this shit.
Right. No, it's amazing, but it's also like the Goon Show. Where like the Goon Show would have somebody go down the stairs and then they would just keep going and keep, and you know, to the point that it's funny and then it's not
funny. And then it's funny again.
And that's the brilliance in Monty Python. And that's also the brilliance in that scene. It's like, you know where it is.
You just got to know when. Okay,
and Evil Dead 2 is another great example of that. Like, you absolutely know where it becomes funny again.
That's because the tone is exactly right. And, and again, the happy accident there is, I believe, is the editor.
The Absolutely.
Editor for Re-Animator went on. He's done a lot of wonderful things. His name is Lee Percy. And for a man to sit there and go, I know how to
trim
this down. I know how to get this down to a little muscular movie.
It's one of those movies. It just puts me in a good mood. I remember seeing Tim Burton's Ed Wood.
Oh, God.
And just like, I didn't know you knew I was out here. You made a movie just for me.
This is kind of movie I actually want to see because I'm getting the reverberation of the history of this and Bela Lugosi.
Yeah.
And all, but at the same time, I am having a blast at this kitsch.
Like, there's a movie about Ed Wood and it doesn't suck.
And it doesn't suck. Yeah. I know.
And Scott and Larry, who wrote it, just wrote Dolemite Is My Name, the story of Rudy Ray Moore, who's basically the Black Ed Wood.
Oh, right. Oh, that's it. It's they're bookending then, aren't they?
But again, it's that they know their brand.
They know what they know the tone they can do. Well, that's Re-Animator really did get me going, but it also sort of pigeonholes you. And as an actor, you don't want to be, hey, you're that horror actor.
It's like, right.
No, dude, I'm an actor and I can do that. But it's like saying, oh, you're just a jazz guitarist, huh?
Right.
Go, well, no.
But it does, as you get older and you have your career, it finds that allows you to do all the other stuff that you want to do.
Yes, it does. You get to be at peace with it. The struggle of like trying to beat the windmill and say, no, I'm more than that. Yeah. I think I've... In my way of doing a lot of Star Trek and
you're a character actor.
I'm a character actor, which is odd about
is odd in Re-Animator because you're the lead.
Well, I'm an anti-hero.
Yeah,
lead.
Yeah,
I'm the guy that at first you think is the bad guy.
Yeah,
and then there's that flip,
right?
And it's like, oh wait, there's somebody worse than me,
right? And the guy who's your friend is
Bruce Abbott?
Bruce Abbott.
I love him. Yeah, he's a good friend of mine.
Where did he go? Because I've seen him in other stuff.
Well, you know, he did some TV stuff. He had a TV series called Dark Justice, I believe. Mm-hmm.
That's right.
A series regular.
Yeah.
He did a couple of other horror movies.
Yeah.
You know, he had a career even before Re-Animator doing... Right. You know, Blue and the Gray. And,
yeah. No, I'd seen him in. I'd seen him in stuff,
other things like that. But you know, this business. It's just
absolutely
spits you out.
Yeah, whatever you get is great.
He's just fine. He lives actually in out by Ojai.
Oh, okay.
He's married to Kathleen Quinlan.
Oh, okay. Terrific.
When we were shooting Re-Animator, he was married to Linda Hamilton.
Really? Wow.
And we I'd go to his dressing room and they were madly in love. And I go, hey, can you guys stop? We have a scene. We have to shoot.
Wow. And now did she marry?
Yes.
What's his name?
Yes.
Yeah.
Titanic. That James guy. Cameron.
James Cameron. Yeah. Yes. And Terminator was right around the same time. Or was it the year before? And Terminator was the year
it
before.
It was a little, was it the year before or a little after that? Oh, yes, it was the year before.
Yeah, it was 84.
And you know why I know? It's because the corpse that we find in the morgue, the big muscular guy, was Schwarzenegger's double.
Oh, that's hilarious.
And I remember being told that at the time. It was like, yeah.
Okay. I thought it was interesting that you put the bone saw through his chest instead of just through his neck. Which seemed to be much easier to me.
Right. But yes, of course. But the gag was the trick, the visual trick that allowed it. It had to be a chest.
Were you a fan of horror movies or did this just happen?
I was a fan of movies.
Yeah.
And when I was a kid, I'd go to, you know, we didn't have this streaming and all of that.
Yeah, of
course. It was either old movies with commercials on
TV,
or it was go to the matinee.
Yeah.
And, whatever was on in the matinee, I was into it.
And did you want to be an actor from when did you know you wanted to be an actor?
Unformed, unknowing, not really aware that was even a possibility. But I did find myself, if I did watch a movie or something on TV, I would then quickly run to my room and reenact it by myself.
Yeah.
And so I think the wiring and the enthusiasm
same thing, but
there.
But it is funny because I grew up like just watching horror movies and Star Trek and things like that. And I just wanted to be in those. Like, I wanted to be an actor, but I wanted to be an actor only in the kind of stuff that I would want to watch. Like, I had no interest in, would you want to be in with Six You Get Egg Roll? No.
Well, but at the same time, when I was a kid, it was like the big thing was cowboys and Indians and war. Combat.
Yeah.
You know? So it was like, I want to be Vic Morrow. And I want to be Zorro.
Right, sure.
I was just, you know, how many times did I run around with a cape going, whoosh, 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 love Zorro.
And you just thought at a certain point, financial stability is not for me.
Let's be an actor. Yeah. I have an idea. I have a road to success here. Starve.
I want to talk about your Edgar Allan Poe show that you're doing up in Tarrytown. And you're also doing Plan 9 from Outer Space.
I am. I'm so excited about that.
Speaking of Ed Wood. Speaking of grown men and Angora sweaters.
You're keeping me in the dark about it, and destroys me.
I'm going to finish it very quickly. You have this giant Star Trek career that I honestly was not fully aware of because I'm like, original series, next gen.
And then nothing.
And then, nothing.
Well, I mean, then it's like, and then.
I love them all. I appreciate them all.
Exactly. But it's kind of like, at that point, the lineage is kind of, it gets a little too much.
But I have very, very good friends. Who are every, you know.
Yeah, they all the iterations.
Yeah, all the iterations. Yeah. What was your big, was it Deep Space Nine or Voyager?
Deep Space Nine.
Yeah. Which is a great show.
It has grown into its own. It was misunderstood middle child at the time, but it was left alone.
Right, right.
They were busy with the movies. And then Voyager launched maybe 2 years after Deep Space Nine because... UPN wanted to start our own network and have a flagship Star Trek. So it was like everybody's focus was somewhere else.
Yeah.
And so it was free.
Did Ron Moore work on Deep Space Nine?
He did.
No, there you go. That's all you need.
Ron Moore, Ira Stephen Baer was head writer. And
Ron Moore, for people who don't know, then went on to create Battlestar Galactica.
Right, exactly.
Yeah.
And so how did that start with me? Well, you know, like anything, I...
Well, you're the only actor to play two characters in one episode.
Well, yes.
Yeah.
Or more accurately, the only actor to play two characters, one episode, and get paid for it.
And get paid for it.
Yeah. I auditioned a couple of times. Thank you very much. Didn't get it. And then I walked in one time, and this goes back to Honky Tonk Freeway.
It's all a circle.
It's all a circle. Because I walk in, and who's directing the episode but Jonathan Frakes.
Uh-huh.
Now, Jonathan Frakes, when I got to my audition...
Married to the chick from General Hospital.
That's right.
Jeannie Francis.
That's right. That's right. Lovely woman. So at that time, I walk in. When I went in to audition for Honky Tonk Freeway the very first time, they said, we're going to pair you up with another actor and you're going to do an improv. You're going to be two thieves that are going to steal a car.
Right.
We'll put two chairs together and action.
Right.
Jonathan Frakes.
Oh, hilarious.
So Jonathan Frakes and I are like, we kind of knew people commonly, but we didn't. So we do this little improv. Thank you very much. And so now, all these years later, I walk in, Jonathan Frakes, number one on
the call sheet.
Next gen.
Yeah,
and now he's directing, and I'm reading for him.
Yeah, he's the king of Star Trek at that point.
Yeah. And so I start to leave, and he goes, hey, Jeff, let me ask you something. I go, yeah. He goes, you know that thing that we were paired up? I go, yeah. He goes, did you get that? Did you get that part? And I went, well, I mean, you know, I got a different part, but I got a part in the movie. And he like slammed the table and looked away like, damn it. I said, Jonathan, I think you're okay. I think you're fine. And then, that's how I got in.
Uh-huh.
And it was a oneer. It was one episode of Alien you'll never see again. However, it's always however.
Uh-huh.
Rene Aubergeois,
right,
who I'd done theater with, was prepping.
The original Father Mulcahy.
That's right. The original Father Mulcahy in MASH.
In the movie MASH.
And Benson.
Yep.
And a bunch of other stuff. I'd done theater with him at the Taper. And he was getting ready to do a Ferengi episode, and he suggested me for a Ferengi, a new character. And they were kind of resistant because he's just been on the show.
Right.
But he said, the makeup. He's a good actor, the makeup. Yeah. And they went, yeah, okay. Well, I started recurring as that role.
Right.
Recurring. And then they asked me, they said, we'd like to see you more of your face. So we're going to have you come back to something. I thought, yeah, man, that's just not going to happen. This is just a compliment. That's right. What that is. Well, it happened. And then I started recurring as that character. And so that's how.
And you've been sort of like a Lon Chaney of Star Trek.
That's a good way of putting it.
Yeah. But that's the job to have. You know, character actors, you can
hide. I can
and
go.
You hide and you can play NEA. You
as
can
I say to my wife, I can go and buy bread and milk.
Mm-hmm.
And no one knows.
Right. But also as an actor, Jeffrey goes, well, yeah, well, I liked him when he was in Re-Animator, but now it's not like a leading man getting long in the tooth. It's like, no, now I'm playing this character.
Now I'm doing that. Character actors have a little more longevity than like a straight ahead leading man.
Yeah.
I've always been character actor. I can play a lead. I've done it. I've done that. But, I'd do it again, buddy.
Yeah, but it's the fun stuff is the character.
But it's like, not as fun, tell you that.
One of my favorite actors was Billy Bob Thornton is one of my favorite actors.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know how to pronounce his last name. Bill Nighy, N-I-G-H-Y, the British actor.
Oh, yes, that guy.
He's great.
He's lovely guy.
And in the 30s and 40s, Dwight Frye.
Loved Dwight Frye.
Yeah, really underrated. And the only guy, like in the original Dracula, which is not a great movie.
Flies.
He's the only actor that gives what I would call a modern performance. Everybody else is very stage-bound.
Very sort of that very presentational, proscenium, very large.
Yeah. And he's giving a completely modern
performance.
It's alive! Yeah. It's
a quiver in the voice. Says, hey! You know, it's like, don't do that.
Did the Lovecraft show come first? Because you did a Lovecraft show, did you not?
Lovecraft show.
Did you do? Oh, you played Lovecraft.
I played Lovecraft.
Right.
Which I was resistant to. Brian Usna had a trilogy movie called Necronomicon, and the wraparound was Lovecraft trying to find the Necronomicon, the book, goes to the library, and as he opens the book, it dissolves into different stories. So it's the wraparound, and at the end, he has this big sort of battle with evil, and it was kind of like, Brian, okay, first of all, I need another 2 feet before I'm actually the height of Lovecraft. And
he actually looked like he had acromegaly a little bit, like he had that distended jaw.
Well, he's a very odd sort. Yeah. But I was very lucky to...
You know who could play him? Clancy Brown.
Clancy Brown could play him. We did Justice League Unlimited, voiced that together. Mm-hmm. And
excellent, excellent
dude. He did some Transformers, too.
Mm-hmm. Excellent guy.
Lovely guy.
Yeah.
So anyway, I was resistant because I thought, A... you're really turning Lovecraft into Indiana Jones here. Mm-hmm. There's nothing swashbuckling about it. But he goes, well, you know, so yes. So, you know, I'm a whore.
We all take,
they pay me.
Take the money.
The makeup was good.
Yeah.
A nose and a chin. And
as James Ellroy said, money is the one gift that no one gives back.
As Zero Mostel says in The Producers, money is honey.
It's so funny. Watched The Producers not too recently.
Oh, God.
And sat next to Mel Brooks.
Light his cigarette. He likes you.
You would never get those close-up shots of Zero Mostel today with those old, like, mid-century smoker's teeth.
Oh,
like,
God.
The no theater. No.
Yeah. And someone would have probably said, can you bring it down a little bit?
Yeah. No, it's amazing.
No. He was going for the back row all the time.
All the time. Mostel. Well, I asked Mel. I worked with him on something. Great guy, Mel. Great guy. And I said to him, could you make Blazing Saddles today? And he said, I could barely make it then.
Barely me.
Atom Age Vampire. You will flame to the stark ritual of a beautiful girl's last searing dance. As tragedy forever mars her loveliness, leaving her to face a world of terror.
I give you my word that I will restore your face. Restore all your beauty.
You will cringe as the demented doctor experiments with a girl's trusting innocence. But to possess the living miracle wrought by his twisted genius, he must forever sacrifice his soul to the cunning gods of evil.
A transplant directly from another human being.
A mad creature born of the atomic age. Now shackled to a world of rotting bodies and violent death. A sadist, a criminal, a depraved animal, more ferocious than Jekyll, more monstrous than Frankenstein, more bloody than Dracula.
Fire a volley through the windowpane.
You will gasp as lust and madness stalk the dark and screaming night in Atom Age Vampire.
Losing hair is no fun. 2 out of 3 guys will experience some form of male pattern baldness by the time they're 35. The good news, with today's advancements in science, Keeps offers proven treatments that can combat the symptoms of hair loss. Keeps has revolutionized the way men are treated for hair loss. You used to have to go to the doctor's office for your hair loss prescription. Now, thanks to Keeps, you can visit a doctor online and get medication delivered to your home. No more waiting rooms, no more pharmacy checkout lines. Get doctor attention and discreet drug delivery, all from the comfort and privacy of your own home. Find out why Keeps has more 5-star reviews than any of its competitors, and nearly 100,000 men trust Keeps for their hair loss prevention medication. Keeps treatments start at just $10 a month. Plus, for a limited time, you can get your first month free. If you're ready to take action and prevent hair loss, go to keeps.com/Dana to receive your first month of treatment for free. That's KEEPS.com/Dana.
Something new is waiting for you at Disneyland. It looks rather innocent, just a big old mansion. But there's a twist. You see, this mansion is haunted.
Greetings, curious mortals. I am your ghost host at the Disneyland Haunted Mansion. Why not make final arrangements to join us soon?
There's a story that Stuart Gordon told me about Mel Brooks. There was a time when Stu had an office on the Disney lot because of Honey, I Shrunk the Kids.
Right. So, which is so funny.
It is.
That he...
I know.
Made Honey, I Shrunk the Kids.
It was him and they came up with it. It was called Teeny Weenies.
Oh, great.
And then they changed it to Honey, I Shrunk the Kids.
But it's like Australian director George Miller.
George Miller, right.
Yeah, and he did Mad Max and then Babe.
And then Babe.
Yeah, and then he went...
Totally, completely.
Yeah, then Happy Feet.
Oh, my God.
And then he went back to Mad Max.
Just whatever.
Yeah.
So they pitched it, and you know they made a deal. But I digress. He told this story about Mel Brooks, that when Mel Brooks first got an office on a lot, he was so excited that across the way from him was Cary Grant's office. He was like, oh, my God, I am near Cary Grant. I'm near Cary Grant. This is amazing. Cary Grant is right across it. And one day they ran into each other and Cary Grant said, let's go to have lunch together. Let's go to the conversation and have lunch together. You and me, that's all. And then he's, oh, yeah, oh, okay, yeah, sure. He was so excited that he was like going to go have lunch with Cary Grant. And so they have lunch. It's a long lunch and a lot of talking. And he's like on cloud nine. Next day, Cary Grant calls him and says, let's have lunch again. Are you free today? You know, and you say, yes, yes. You know, well, this went on for a while until it was like one day Cary Grant called and secretary said, Mr. Grant's on the day. Tell him I'm out.
That's
be careful when you,
I know,
when you meet your
heroes. I had a thing at Tower Records, and I saw a nameless indie rock star that I had seen.
Why nameless?
Because
it's bad.
No, it's I don't, people that know him might listen to the show.
I get it.
I walk up to him. I go, hey, I saw you in Boston at the Rat in about 1985 with Peter Holzapfel from the DBs open for you. And I was like, I remember that. And then it was just like, and then he's like, I don't have any of my stuff here. And then I'm just walking around and it's just like, okay, bye. Okay, bye.
See you later. I had the same thing with David Crosby.
Really?
I had like an Encino post office, you know? And I walk in there and I go, that guy putting letters in the box. That's fucking David Crosby. Oh my God. We have all been here before. You know, so I went over to him. I said, you know, Mr. Crosby, I was telling you, man, I just love your music. And he like snarled at me and it was like, wow.
Oh, that's awful.
Wow. That hurts. That same thing with John Voight once.
Did he really? Twain's. What did he say?
He didn't say anything. He just looked at me and like lifted his lip, like get out of my space.
Oh man.
It was like,
that's a drag.
Oh, okay. It's John Voight did the same thing.
Well, he's clearly in Twain's at Coldwater and Ventura.
Exactly. Before it was a Sharky's.
Yeah, now it's a Sharky's. I was just going to
say. Which is a Mexican restaurant for those of you who don't. Good.
That's a good one, dude.
Good change.
Well, he's insane.
But he was not kind, you know? It's like, I love your work. And it was like, you know, get the fuck away from me.
You know, you always.
Don't do that.
No, don't do that. Those people are your boss. And I was with George Carlin.
Wait. You were with George Carlin.
I was with George.
You were like hanging with George Carlin.
Yes, I was. We were not friends, friendly acquaintances, I would say.
That's right. You were in the same kind of circle.
Same business. And he was never, ever, ever lost on me for a second that I was in his company. Right. Like I was never, right. I was always very
reverent.
Aware.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. No, he was my hero. He was, I'm still,
well,
is, yeah. Yeah.
I went and saw him. I'll tell you, I went and saw him in Vegas. Soon, not too long before he passed away.
And that's what would happen is you'd be talking and people would just walk up and, you know, sometimes just interrupt. I saw you in St. Louis at the Circle at the blah, 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 in 1977. Yeah, yeah. And he was as funny as he was, and he was a genius. He was nicer as a human being. He was so always kind and gave people their time and attention and just things that I've learned from him. Touch their elbow, make eye contact.
Listen,
ask them
thank
their
you
name,
very much. Appreciate you coming by. He's genuine about
he's
it.
He's genuine about it. Because one time we were talking and the guy really just like kind of rudely like cut him off. We were talking, this guy just kind of burst in. And when he walked away, I kind of arched my eyebrow and he just shrugged and said, this moment's not about us. This moment's about him.
He's right.
Yeah, absolutely.
However, when I saw him,
did he unload on a heckler?
You betcha.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I've heard some of those tapes.
He came out and he had like papers in front of him and he said, I want you to know that I'm working on an HBO special. And just because I have these papers in my hand, it doesn't mean that I am not going to give you just as good a show as anybody else. And so he starts and he came to some sort of punchline or a moment in one of his bits, and some guy thought he'd fill in the blank out there, and there was a pinner pause, and then he went, listen, you cocksucker.
Yeah. Yeah.
You are not the one being paid up here on the stage. If I hear one more word out of you, you are going to be kicked out of here on your ass.
Yeah. Oh, I've heard tapes where he goes a lot harder.
But the point is like, now we're going to have a lot of fun. Now everybody is like, So it wasn't quite the raucous evening after that.
Yeah, because, no, I had this that Saturday night. I was in Denver Saturday night performing at the Comedy Works. And a guy shouted out something that was like he had seen me before and anticipated.
So
the punchline.
He knew your joke. Yeah, yeah. Killed it.
And I just like, just kept going. A lot of those things I don't, my attitude is best way to put out a fire is deprive it of oxygen. After the show, one of the things about comedy that's changed is now there's a meet and greet after the show. Like you go out there and you sign.
So now you just can't go and have a cigarette and go get a burger somewhere. No, you're obligated to.
Selfie time, yeah. But it's great. But again, it's part of the communication.
It is.
People who listen to this podcast, they feel they know me.
Networking.
Yeah. And I love it when people go, I love your podcast. I listen to it on the way to work. That makes me feel great.
Exactly.
That guy came up to me and he was with his mom and he was clearly not 100%.
There you go.
And so I'm like, thank God I didn't.
I didn't, because then you would have gone into the middle of someone who just doesn't have the protocol.
Right, exactly. And it was, and his mother, like, she goes, he loves comedy. And I was just like,
okay.
And it was one of those things like, whew.
Imagine if you had.
Yeah. We're both performing at the Sleepy Hollow Film Festival.
We are.
And you're doing your show. It's now called Nevermore.
Always has been called Nevermore.
But it had a longer title at first.
Well, it's called Nevermore, An Evening with Edgar Allan Poe. But, come on.
At the Steve Allen.
Steve Allen, which, by the way, I drove by the Steve Allen Theater. Schmuck, schmuck. And I bet a lot of your listeners don't know what I just did.
No, but I do.
Oh, yeah, I know.
I was the first performer on stage at the Steve Allen Theater.
We need a hotel bell here.
I was the first performer on stage at the Steve Allen.
You were?
Because Jim Underdown.
Yes.
Who started the Steve Allen.
Yes.
I met Jim when he was a carpenter working on my house.
And he said, you know, I'm working on this.
And then
theater.
We just stayed in touch. And then he did this theater. And
I love that. I love that. Well, I went by it the other day. It's a wasteland.
I don't know what it is now.
It is. I have pictures on my phone. I'll show them to you. It is chicken wire fence around it and gravel and a pile of rubble over.
Did
where
they
the
raise the building?
It's gone, baby.
Where's Amit now?
I just talked to Amit.
Where's he now?
He is partially semi-moved up into Mendocino. He bought a cabin up there.
On brand. He looks like a mountain man anyway.
I call him professor and he calls me doctor.
Yeah, he looked like Amit Edelman, who's the sweetest guy on earth. He was programmed the Steve Allen Theater.
Oh, I
looks
love him.
Like young Mr. Natural.
Yes, he does. Young Mr. Keep on Trucking, big long beard. Yeah. And every night before I would
Rick Rubin for the kids.
Yeah. And every night before I would go on, he would, of course, have to go out and go, thank you all for coming and
right.
turn your cell phones off and all that. So we'd meet up backstage and every night I'd say, listen, Amit, I'm just not up to it. Would you go on? would you do the show? And he'd go, you want me to do it? Because I'm ready. I'm ready right now to do it. And I go, I can tell that you're ready. So
how did Nevermore come about? Were you like, because it's again, it's on brand.
Sort of, but that wasn't the intent.
Right. He's a fascinating guy.
Well, that is what caused it.
Here's one thing I learned about him, just doing a cursory observation.
Yeah.
Sort of the first American writer to make his living only as a writer.
Not true.
Well, that's what it was. One of the first, like outside of like Twain, but like one of the early famous writers.
He was dreadfully poor. Most
yes,
of his
as
life.
Was Lovecraft.
But he made his living, but his day job was usually as an editor of magazines, which were weekly things that right. there were a slew of them.
Mm-hmm.
They were very popular, kind of, you know. And an editor and as a literary critic for those magazines.
Uh-huh.
So not only would he put the magazine together, he would have to read other people's works and right. critique them.
Right.
And at the same time, he'd look down and go, we need to fill that space. I guess I better write something.
Right.
A lot of his stories that he's really well known were kind of last minute, like got to get something, which is spectacularly amazing to
yeah.
me. Very quick turnaround on that stuff, and yet they're genius. But he considered himself a poet. He made $11 for The Raven. I'm just saying.
Yeah.
In $11 in yeah. in those times, which right. was probably what, $500 now? Yeah. I don't know.
And with the internet, he could make $11 for it again.
Exactly. Now we're back.
Yeah, now we're back.
What goes around comes around. So he lived most of his life in abject poverty, and he couldn't keep a job because I think he was kind of maybe a little bipolar.
I met Gary Lockwood, and we were talking about Kubrick.
Uh-huh.
And I said, so in retrospect, because everything you read about Kubrick, however you pronounce
whatever
his name. To me, it goes like, oh, he was on the spectrum. Because everything is unemotional chess master, brilliant guy, but like very cold and distant. It sounds to me like somebody with Asperger's or somebody on the spectrum.
Somebody who's just, yeah.
Exactly. Yeah, and I said, so did you think he was? And he goes, fuck no. No, he was just a really smart guy.
He's just regular dude, but he's just really smart.
Yeah, and he told me this funny story. He said, I was in a bar, and it was just one of those, like, I was in a bar in Nebraska or some, like, weird place. I walk in, Slim Pickens is in there with his wife.
Wow.
Yeah.
He must have had a ranch nearby.
Something. And I goes, Slim, I just, and I knew him from TV, and I said, hey, I just did a movie with Stanley over in London for a year. And Slim goes, hell, you two on the same set must have been just getting up early to see who'd mind fuck each other first. And I think he's just one of those guys.
You know how
Slim, too smart for
you know
his
why
own good.
Slim Pickens is in?
Yes, I do. Peter Sellers
broke his leg.
Yeah.
Which is why he sits down as the president, which is why he's in a wheelchair.
Yep.
Which is why also that British, Jack. Mm-hmm. Could you put the gun down, Jack?
Yeah.
You know, he's never moving around.
No.
He's just standing there or is a...
And I mean, that's my favorite comedy of all time.
I just adore
Dr. Strangelove.
Movie.
And what's interesting about Dr. Strangelove, in my opinion, my humble opinion, Sterling Hayden, the only guy to ever
genius.
Blow Peter Sellers off screen.
Absolutely.
No one is looking at Peter Sellers in those
two
shots.
No. The dynamic...
Yeah,
a dynamic power there. That's just—he
looked like a wingtip shoe, and he's just
madness on steroids.
Yeah, and so the gravity of, and so many little things where he sets the pistol down on the desk, and the pistol's pointed right at Sellers, and he goes, "Do you realize as we're sitting here talking?" So enjoyably.
So enjoyably.
but let's get back to poetry. Yeah. Did you write this?
No, I didn't. It started out, I was looking, I love history, and I was reading books to find, yet again, like I said before, unformed, I was kind of trying to find a historical character mm-hmm. that I could portray. And I wasn't even thinking about stage or, you know, I was thinking about, in my quixotic way, like a historical movie. They don't do them anymore.
Right.
But mm-hmm. that was where I was. So I was looking for somebody I might be able to play in history. And I wasn't really finding anything. And my motive was not horror. Nothing.
I'm just trying to branch out here
and do something completely different.
Yeah.
But I come across I have it over there, a particular biography of Poe. And I went, okay, all right. Right away, I think it said he's 5'8", and hazel eyes. And I'm going, well, I'm 5'8", I have hazel eyes. That's the beginning,
right?
And so I started reading, and I just became truly fascinated with his life, his brain, his dynamics, his situation. It was so challenging for him. It's tragic.
Yeah. And his mother died. His
mother died when he was 2 or 3.
Yeah. And then his father split and his mother died. And
his father had already hit the road.
Yeah.
Then when he was adopted by a family who kind of viewed him as sort of they were childless and she wanted a baby. The father didn't really care. They sort of adopted him, took him in, but he was more like a thing than a child. His best friend's mother he adored, she died early. Then his adopted mother died early.
Yeah.
And then he married
his cousin.
Jerry Lee Lewis got nothing on him. He married his first cousin, adored her though. And then she was 13. Mm-hmm. And she,
different time before we lose our minds. Different era.
I have in there my family tree that goes back, like who married who and when and what the dates were. And if you do some of the math, I wouldn't be here if a couple of my predecessors weren't strong women who were 14 and got married.
Some of your predecessors weren't picking green apples.
They were not. So, he just fascinated me. And I mentioned it to Stuart. Why hasn't anybody made a movie? Like, you've got Lust for Life and Van Gogh's struggles. Why not Poe? And he didn't say much. And about a year later, I got an email with a script for Masters of Horror on it, mm-hmm. The Black Cat. And so I did that. And while we were shooting it, Stuart said, you ought to do a one-man show. And I'm like, get out of here. I don't want to do That's a lot of work, man.
It is a lot of work.
Oh, come on.
Yeah.
But, he was Yoda. He was gentle and persistent. And maybe a year and a half later, I went, well, what would that be? What would we do? And then we formed it, and it almost organically.
Uh-huh.
Organically.
Sort of fell together.
Just kind of like so easily that it was maybe sort of destined. He called and said, I've got a theater. I'll meet Steve Allen Theater. They'll put it on 4 weeks. 4 weeks bloomed into like a year and a half,
two years.
And then I started doing it around the country. Mm-hmm. Different places invited me.
For those of you who haven't seen it but are going to come and see it, how does the show, what is the show?
It's basically an imagined recital. In those days, the only way that authors could actually make money other than what they first sold their stories for, because this is how bad it was. If you sold your story to a magazine and they printed it, every other magazine and newspaper in the country would go, well, you got paid. We'll print it.
Right.
And then there was no royalty.
No.
So the only way you could augment your livelihood was to basically a public appearance.
Which is what bands are back to doing now.
Bingo. Stays the same.
Yeah, it really does.
And it really does. So this is an imagined recital that goes sideways, as things with Poe will do.
What do you mean?
Well, he had issues and mm-hmm. grievances, and he also would take a nip every once in a while.
Right.
And so as this goes on,
that's amazing.
The bottle pulls out, and when I do it, the audience is elated.
Right.
celebratory. Now we're going to have a party, but we know that that lasts for a while, and then it becomes someone take that bottle away from him, please. Because now we're going into a place that we kind of shouldn't. So it kind of, and then there's redemption at the end.
What was the poem you wrote about?
Annabelle Lee.
Yeah.
About Poe always felt that the highest form of poetry, I have a quote, I say, the object of poetry being to please, the effect chosen by the poet must, in some measure, occasion pleasure. And that pleasure, which is the most intense, most elevated, most pure, is the contemplation of the beautiful. And beauty, in whatever form, in its supreme development, it invariably excites the sensitive soul to tears. The tone, therefore, of purest poetry must be melancholy.
Ah.
He believed that a young woman losing her life far too soon was the apex of poetry.
And he was...
He knew that very well.
Yeah, I was going to say he was bombarded with it throughout his life.
It was like gamma rays on him. It was just imprinted from a very early age. And
he died at 40?
39.
39, yeah. And they don't know there's...
It's a mystery.
Yeah.
A mystery. I'd say it's a combination of maybe getting mugged, rolled, drugged. You know, in those days...
Forty in those days was not terrible.
That was a good long life.
Yeah,
and there were polling things going on. They would go around and pick up people that were drunk, change their clothes, and then have them go vote again, and then give them a drink, sometimes not so good alcohol, and then change their clothes and have them go somewhere else and vote.
It was a whole rig,
and he was.
Thank God we've got that straightened out.
Oh yeah, that's all solved now. It's modern era now. So he was found in somebody else's clothes and delirious, and he hung on for 2 or 3 years. I actually read a book that the physician who treated him wrote, but like 20 years later he wrote it because, he's famous? Let me make some money on this.
Right. And as you said, it's probably bipolar or some schizoaffective disorder.
Could be health, could be his own alcoholism, it could be bad alcohol, it could be... hepatitis C, innumerable things. We just don't know. It's a mystery. Buried in a pauper's grave in Baltimore, just in the back of the church way back there, just, you know, another one bites the dust. And then 20 years go by and they go, wait, he's famous? They were, let's dig him up and give him a big monument right up front.
Did he invent detective fiction?
Yes. Yes, that he did. Yes, he did. And it's not me saying that. It's Arthur Conan Doyle. Mm-hmm. Poe created a story about a guy named Dupin, Inspector Dupin, who lived in Paris, a place Poe's never been. But it was a mystery of two women in an upstairs apartment that was, the door was locked and there was no way to get in there. And they had been cut up with a razor blade and no one knew how that could be. And Dupin, without going anywhere, without doing any inspecting of any kind, just based on clues, deduced that it was a sailor who had brought an orangutan into port, and the orangutan had escaped and climbed up the into the room and had panicked with a razor blade and killed them and ran away.
Which is the seed of the murders in the room.
Bingo.
A terrible gorilla suit.
Right. So it's all of this, the idea that you could deduce from clues was a completely new device.
Right.
New device.
Amazing.
So there would be no Elementary, My Dear Watson.
Yeah, without a URL.
Without Poe.
And the Poe Literary Prize is the mystery.
The Edgar.
Yeah, the Edgar.
The Edgar. He also, they say, was one of the first science fiction writers.
Mm-hmm.
He wrote a really, I think he was on acid. I don't think it existed actually, but he, very acidic thing.
Yeah.
He
wrote, or it could have been on opium, which was.
Yeah, I'm not sure he was too into that at all. Some people think he was, but I one time he a engagement that he was engaged and she broke it off and he went and got some laudanum, like he was gonna kill himself, and so he took half of it and then he decided he'd write her a letter, and then he forgot to take the other half, so he didn't really
yeah,
but he was gonna like off himself, but he didn't. So everybody goes, oh, he was a drug addict. Well, no, you know, laudanum was like cough syrup or something.
Right, yeah. It was also, it was clearly at the very least manic depressive. I mean, clearly untreated.
Yes, he was a bit bipolar, I think. It was highs and lows.
Yeah.
There are two descriptions I have in my notes of like a genteel Southern gentleman and just somebody who you found in the gutter.
I'm not comparing these two people at all. But the same description was Jim Morrison.
Well, that's a motif that maybe sounds about
I'm not
right.
Comparing them.
People are strange.
Yeah, it was just one of those guys who was like, great guy, not when he was drunk. And as it got going, he was drunk more than sober.
And so in my play, I get going. And when he gets going, it's all of the stuff that's really on his mind, really.
Well, Super, thanks so much.
Are we done?
We're done. That's it. We're
can't be.
106.
I love you.
Thanks, buddy.
I hope you come to my show.
Oh, no, we're coming. Yeah, we're coming. Yeah.
And I'll pick you out. And I'll.
Yeah, no, we're coming. It's going to be great.
All right. Thanks, Dana.
Jeffrey Combs, ladies and gentlemen.
Yes, sir. May I help you?
Oh, I'd like two of those, please.
Hot dogs? Yes, sir.
And three of those. And one of those. And five bars of these. And a cup of that nice hot liquid.
Coffee. Coming right up.
Oh, and two bags of those peculiar white puffy material.
You mean our crunchy popcorn. Shall I wrap that for you, sir?
Oh, that's all right. My saucer's just outside.
They come from miles to enjoy our intermission.
They come from the bowels of hell, a transformed race of walking dead. Zombies guided by a master plan for complete domination of the Earth. Plan 9 from outer space. Starring the most nightmarish cast ever, Bela Lugosi, the seductive Vampira, and Tor Johnson as the Walking Dead.
Turn off your electro gun! No! No! Stop him, Dennis!
I can't get it, it's jammed!
Stop him, you fool!
Bullets bounce off their bodies. Rockets, missiles, jets cannot stop their death ships. What earthly power can stop this terror? For a glimpse of things to come, see this blast of screen suspense. For it could be happening right now.
Settle back now, content, comfortable, well-fed, and ready for some fine entertainment. Is everybody happy? Then let's go. It's showtime.
It's Halloween, and we have two genre experts pulled from the deep, deep recesses of my phone book. An incredibly talented writer and director. He has also produced Tales of Halloween, kind enough to stick me in that. Nice to see people willing to lower the bar to keep a friendship going. You wrote and directed Big Ass Spider. It follows. Don't kill it, which is amazing.
Thank you.
And underrated and hilarious. And you're a writer on Stand Against Evil.
Yes.
And please welcome the lovely and talented Mike Mendez.
Hello. Hello. This is the sound of my voice here. And thank you so much for having us on again. This is it's always a great pleasure to hang.
It's a good tradition. And the owner and operator of the excellent podcast Monster Party.
Spread that around.
And when I moved to San Francisco in the 80s and was a comic, I was a comedian, but unlike most comedians, I didn't like spend my day either getting stoned or doing blow.
Right.
You know, I was like watching monster movies and building resin garage kits.
With me on occasion.
Well, yeah, it was the heyday of the resin garage.
What was going on in the 80s in San Francisco and every other apartment but yours, you know?
Well, that was the thing. But then I met...
Literally cruising is happening next door while you're doing your Aurora kit.
100%. And then I literally met like... another guy, another comic, similar background, into the exact same stuff that I was into. It was odd and delightful. And we've been close friends ever since. Please welcome the lovely and talented Matt Weinhold.
Hi, this is the sound of my voice. Excellent. I am Matt Weinhold.
We did, we were like, we would call each other like, hey, my Dremel's broke.
Yeah. My favorite thing ever was you and I working in San Diego at the Improv, and Alex Reed comes over. He's working someplace else, and he shows up, and we've got our drills out, and we've got putty, and he just walks in and just looks at us and just goes, nobody's getting laid here. And we're like, what?
Girls don't like model kits anyway. Yeah, no, it was amazing.
Who was the better craftsman?
Oh, I'm Matt.
Okay, all right.
Yeah. Only because I just put a lot of time into it. There's a lot of mistakes.
The whole airbrushing and the...
I never did airbrushing, but when I discovered dry brushing, that was like a revelation, because now I could
Matt discovered dry brushing the way I discovered dry humping.
They're not far apart. You can use a brush.
It looks like an expert did.
Is that a Weinhold?
Yeah. When I discovered that, I moved down to Los Angeles and I discovered paying better people to build your kits.
No. Oh, I would do that. Like I've got a closet full of kits that's like, all right, when I hit that, I could no longer walk anymore.
Interesting choice of words.
Yeah, I know.
Kits. Yeah. I'm building an army of women.
Yeah, no, I it's so funny. There's a store here in Los Angeles in Studio City called Kitcraft.
Kitcraft.
Oh yeah.
Of course, yeah.
Which, and when you go to Kitcraft, by the way, this conversation is the leading cause of vaginal dryness. You go to Kitcraft and there's all these kits that, like, oh my god, Odd Job, Barnabas Collins, they have everything.
Yeah, right.
They still have it.
Yeah. Right.
But there was a guy named Tom Gilliland, and I learned about Kitcraft through another comedian, Rick Overton,
whose work is all over the place in there.
It was a brilliant model builder.
Oh wow.
Craftsman. Long story longer, I had the very, very impossible to build Tom Kuntz Vampira kit, Vampira on the settee.
Oh shit.
It's with fishnet stockings you need to paint. You're not gonna do it.
I love his stuff as a sculptor.
Yeah, yeah. Tom Kuntz is great.
I love fishnet stockings, as you know.
Tom Gilliland did my build up for me, and he now runs Sideshow.
Yeah, I remember. I think he started it. I used to be one of those kids that would come to watch him paint.
And watch
because, you know, I was obviously getting some tail back then too.
Sure, now.
Wow, that's an afternoon. You know, like, just to cruise the crowd, right?
You want to go to Kitcraft and watch bottles get painted?
Excuse me, that's Kelly Green.
I can't believe you're so stupid.
Yeah, I think you're going to want to use a mat on
right
that.
Now he's doing the dark wash, you see, which is...
Oh, you're not going to prime it. They're just...
I got to buy a place now.
This is a festival of mistakes.
Yeah. You're not going to prime it. Bold.
But I don't have that kit anymore. My daughter didn't like it.
Oh, no.
I scared my daughter, and I gave it away, and now I wish I still had it.
Right.
I can't get it.
You know, there are attics that you can put things in.
Oh, my God. He's an artist. I mean, he was one of a kind, his paint jobs.
He's still around, and he's good for like a... like stuff that you can't believe is like, oh my God, his work is so good.
Mm-hmm. Sideshow just changed my life, really. I mean, that whole company.
It made me poorer.
Yeah. Well,
I live in a box now.
Compared to now.
Your mint in box.
Yeah, exactly.
Compared to now, though, where it's Hot Toys, everything's $250.
Right.
There was that time where you could get for $40 to $50.
Sweet spot. Get a toy in Frankenstein.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
And beautiful.
Amazing.
Yeah, they knew the price point.
Yeah,
they knew the price point.
Now they're like, oh fuck you,
no,
$200.
We got you. We got your number.
So like with Funko too, it's like, is there anything they don't make? You know, it's like,
I know.
You know, do you want the Simon Oakland Funko or do you want the?
I don't want any pops.
My big Funko right now is collecting people I know. There's a few of them. Not that many, but I'm like, keep doing that. That's great.
Yeah, that's good.
So if there's a Dana Gould, I will gladly.
There is one, I think. But
is there really?
I need that.
The funk. I think
that's a sex doll.
What scale are we talking about?
No, there's
one to one.
There's a garage kit one.
That's with the open mouth.
I look alarmed. I look alarmed, and if you fill me with helium, I float away.
And the hand is limp.
The wrist is broken just like that. So it's Halloween. I wanted to do like a recap of horror films from the year, like stuff that people might not see or might not be aware of that's out there to see. There's always the classics. Like I have like mandatory Halloween viewing. Mm-hmm. Once it gets into October, I force my kids with increasing difficulty as they get older, to watch It's the Great Pumpkin. Inevitably, we'll watch, John Carpenter's The Thing, American Werewolf. I try not to watch them during the year.
Right. I try to get them,
but it is interesting. It's like, I'll watch American Werewolf, I'll watch John Carpenter's The Thing and a couple other ones. All of them were like, I saw them. They came out when I was in high school.
Right, right.
You know, it really is. What's the best era for movies? The one where I was 16.
Right. I was a little younger. I was like American Werewolf and The Thing were some of the first horror movies I ever saw. I was like 7. But they changed my life.
Yeah.
You know, it's like I was a different person after. I mean, I think I always had that macabre in me, but like, you know, life changed.
Yeah, sure.
I feel like we just got lucky.
Yeah, I think
I feel
so
like
too.
We just happened to grow up in this golden age. I mean,
because you've listened of the things that come out in 1982, like E.T. and
I worked at I was an usher that year at the theater, so I saw everything 400 times. 1982 was a crazy great year for movies.
Yeah, absolutely.
It was, and movies that were bombs, like
The Thing,
John Carpenter's The Thing,
right.
Blade Runner,
sure,
both of them.
I mean, compared to now, and I don't know how often you go out to the theater.
Clint Eastwood in Firefox.
Well, that sucked.
That's just...
I believe Rocky III was 1982. Dead Men Don't Wear Plaid.
Oh, that's a good movie.
I think
movie.
It was 1982.
I love that movie.
Yeah, a lot of them. And then, obviously, you know, the E.T. and all. E.T. just, like, smeared itself over that summer like marshmallow fluff. Like, there was
and killed
E.T.
The Thing, I think, in a lot of ways.
Oh, just, people hated The Thing because it came out like 2 weeks after E.T. and it was the beginning of the 80s and it was
this alien doesn't like candy.
Yeah, but it was the Reagan era and it was just like the beginning. I remember that summer was the three big hits on the radio were Jack and Diane by John Cougar, later John Cougar Mellencamp, Rock the Casbah, and Come On Eileen by Dexy's Midnight Runners. Those are the big hits that summer.
The last one you mentioned is probably the only one that I can still listen to.
Or Come On Irene?
Come on, Irene.
Yeah, it's also a good Bukkake film.
I was just going to say, also a video, a downloadable video.
You got to see the hentai version of that.
Yeah.
Come
video.
On, Eileen was a Bukkake video that Buddy Ebsen made about Irene Ryan. Jed, they're coming on me.
But you compare it to movies now. I don't know how often you go to the theater, but it's like, how many great movies now? I'm not talking Beyond Fest and festivals and things like that. How about great movies did you see at the theater this year? And I really like start drawing a blank, you know?
Well, yeah. I mean, I saw one last night. I saw Dolemite.
But yeah, that's a Netflix original. And you went to a festival for that.
Are there movies? I mean, isn't everything a Netflix? I mean, I think that we'll talk about Midsummer. Isn't that already streaming?
It is now because I just watched it.
Yeah,
it's on iTunes. I'm excited to talk about that.
The window from theater to streaming
is the good news is that there's so much great content, and I get annoyed when people say, "Oh, you know, these Netflix horror films." Well, there are of course a million bad ones, but there are also a lot of really good horror films now. But you'll never see them in a theater.
Yeah.
I mean, right, maybe two or three or something like that.
There's some good stuff on Netflix, like The Ritual and things like that from last
year.
Yeah,
great.
But, you know,
great.
Yeah, and I say to myself, I'd love to have seen this in a theater.
Yeah.
But you don't get that.
Did The Witch ever make it to a theater?
Oh, The Witch was a theater.
Okay.
Yeah. There's still good stuff. A24 is kind of the ones putting out like the really,
some
really
great stuff out there. Stuff.
One thing I'm sick of is this is unrelated to horror movies. People who complain that because of PC culture, their voices are being stifled. And it seems like every time you turn on the radio or the TV or a podcast, all you can hear is them complaining that they can't say anything anymore.
Right, right.
Sure.
And it's like, can't hear anything else but them having a voice.
Yeah.
Complaining that they don't have a voice.
Is this a subtweet on Todd Phillips?
It's that whole school. Yeah, Ben Shapiro. It's like, how come you, if you can't talk, how come you're the only thing I can fucking hear?
Right.
A24, what was the one that you were just talking about?
Midsummer?
No, the one before that. The Ritual.
Oh, that's a really cool film that's kind of like a little bit like The Descent meets The Wicker Man-ish, you know. It's four guys in the woods and just kind of creepy stuff happens, and then they kind of meet a kind of tribe in the woods, but that's a really effective kind of neat little
film. I love that idea.
Yeah, it's a cool movie. But again, one that it's so much these days is so much about word of mouth, you know, because, you know, these movies don't have really like an advertising budget. It's not like you're seeing commercials for these things or trailers.
And
it's just people tell you, oh, my God, you know, the best source for me. And
it's
really
not a part of a unit. You have to tell people Iron Man is not in this movie. Totally. But they still made it.
In my slash fiction, he is.
And I swear to God, this is not a cheap plug. What I loved, honestly, is Shudder. You know, I mean, Shudder is giving us not blown smoke up your ass, creep show. But just the fact that we get a creep show TV show in this era, which, you know, is so lost on kids today. No one except like us in
our 40s matter. Yeah.
Like, appreciate it. But just the fact that it's a love letter to the original American film.
Yeah.
And it's so funny when we had the... I remember the creep show was 80.
Yeah, right. 1980.
80, 81. I was in 10th grade. And when we had the premiere at the Egyptian Theater here in good old Los Angeles, California, they showed the trailer for the movie for Creep Show.
Right.
Just as part of it. And it's old. And like, oh yeah, it's an old movie.
Yeah,
it's like that was a different era.
Well, it blows my mind when like you, and this is, I'm going to reference an old movie.
Old trailer guy voice.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Time.
But
for horror,
you know, it's just like
I was seeing
Stephen King, master of horror.
Yeah,
when I was watching Rambo, not the one that just came out, but the one that came out 12 years ago, and I can't believe it was already 12 years ago.
The one that came out 12 years ago that people were also saying, I can't believe he made another Rambo.
Right? Yes, exactly. Yes. When that one,
they kind of fun. By the way,
it's fucking great.
Yeah. Is that where he's in Thailand or something?
Yeah. Burma. And, yeah, it's better than a Friday the 13th.
Incredibly violent.
It's
a pretty good time actually.
No, I heard.
It was great.
The new one, not so much. But the,
what's the, and the new one is he's at the Screen Cartel. Actors Retirement Home in Northridge.
Yeah. There's a zoning problem in the neighborhood.
He's trying to protect the Caesar statue.
But they show flashbacks to the 80s Rambo. Uh-huh. And when you look at it, like the flashback like that, you're like, Jesus Christ, that's like an old movie. Like, that reminds me of like when I was a kid and they do a flashback to something from the 50s.
Sure.
Like, that's what it feels like now.
Absolutely. You know? Yeah, no, it is true. And it's also weird. Like, you think, do you ever have this happen? You're like, you're talking about, oh my God, this is the funniest movie. You have to see this movie. It's so funny. And then you watch it. And it's so slow.
Yeah.
It just, it's just like we're so, everything is so sped up. And, you know.
I lost some people on Being There.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I never got into that, but I saw that I liked the first time when I was 7. So yeah. I always thought it was a boring film, but.
Unusual and a nice kind of acting tour de force.
That's great.
And then, but then you show it to somebody else, and they're like,
"Last movie.
When's something going to happen?" Like, never.
Yeah. So. Well, sometimes people just talk. That's a movie.
Yeah.
Well, I don't even know if they could do that now.
Oh, sure.
Like the Lumberjack song. I don't think you could do anymore.
Well, see, and that's why people complain about the whole, political correctness thing, is that there was a time when things were just ridiculous.
Absurd. But it was like political correctness. You can't go back in time and look for stuff to be offended by.
Sure. No.
It was a different era.
What are you going to erase Don Rickles?
Yeah, it was a different period. But Al Jolson had a great career. Wouldn't today.
No.
Eddie Cantor. Al Jolson.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But try watching something like Revenge of the Nerds with your kids and see how
that's maybe the best one.
Yeah. Oh, it's terrible. It's unbelievable now.
16 Candles is another one.
Animal House.
Here, take my girlfriend.
Yeah, Animal House.
How about more peeping Tommy? Although the whole he doesn't.
He has that scene where he's like rape her, fucking brains up.
He doesn't.
He doesn't.
But still, it's just like. Cart.
But he does have sex with a 13-year-old girl, and that's like.
that's not good now, huh?
if the family is okay.
Good Lord, yeah.
If the armies need to merge.
Right. No, it's incredible. You watch these films and they're so offensive now.
Yeah.
But I will say, even as a kid watching Revenge of the Nerds, there's a scene where he puts the Darth Vader mask on and has sex with her, and then she's like, "Oh, you were amazing," and then he reveals that he was a nerd, but nerds are good at sex, so it's okay.
Yeah, no, it's not.
Even at 7, I was like, "What the fuck?"
It's awful.
It was terrible. And
George Meyer, the Simpsons writer, had my favorite observation about that movie was that football players, no one cared about nerds. Like, we were invisible. Football players didn't walk around, "Nerds!" We didn't even know you were alive.
In my school a little bit, but.
it's true. It's hilarious.
So many hilarious date rapes.
In the 80s. Yeah, and it's like, it's just a different time. It's a really different time. That sounds like a great movie, and that's streaming now. The Ritual,
yeah, Ritual's streaming now. That one's a little older. That was from 2018. So, but I have lots of good 2019.
Go ahead.
If we're gonna go just a little bit farther back,
we can go back to whenever.
Okay. Because this is
a podcast. I don't even think I have sponsors anymore.
Yeah. Is this going to be?
I'm going to get into the really low rent sponsor. Would you like to learn to draw?
Flamenco in the nude. Yeah, lessons exactly. Available now.
Store-bought Q-tips have you up a tree. Why not make your own Q-tips? Yeah, whatever the terrible.
But here's
I have to hawk
the movie that I think is so great, which I thought could have been an Oscar contender, because that's how great it was, in my opinion, is Hereditary.
Oh, fuck yeah.
Hereditary is the shit.
Yeah.
I mean, that movie is, like, to me, if you're going into Halloween and you want to get the shit scared out of you, not in a Conjuring way, not in Annabelle, but, like, genuine horror from, like, 9 different levels.
Yep.
It's Hereditary.
It's not for everybody.
I will say...
It's brutal.
I'm a huge fan.
As a parent, when that one thing happens,
right,
sure. I was like ready to check out. Like, he They do earn it back.
Yeah.
That's a big one.
But that's so upsetting that I have points for just going there and making, because yes. I feel that's what yes. what I love about Ari Aster's stuff is
Me
I
too.
Feel horrible during his movies. It's, yeah. it's misery porn.
Yeah.
You know, it's just how, what awful thing could I, and I love it, but I'm just like, oh my yeah. God, I have anxiety. My stomach's in yeah. I feel terrible. This yeah. is the greatest movie ever.
I knew we had a classic here when I had a nightmare after it.
Shit,
that
really?
Never happens. Uh-huh. I had a nightmare. And as you were saying, yeah, the fact that he goes there and there are these twists that, you know, to a lesser filmmaker, it would just be a gimmick. But
no, I thought it was also
integral to the story.
Yeah, and having seen 4,000 movies, I didn't have it all figured out 5 minutes in.
No,
yeah,
this was great.
I often get in this debate with people because they often go, "It's great until the ending," and I'm like, "I don't know what you have a problem with the ending. The ending is batshit nuts, and really? Everything. Yeah. And if you watch that movie, and I've seen it several times." It's all in there. It's yeah. all paved
oh,
the
yeah.
way toward
yeah.
brilliant.
And yeah. there are just images that even if you turn the sound off and you just watched the visuals in that film, especially toward the end,
yeah, yeah.
there are some things where I just go like, I've never seen that before.
No, right. It's one of the best directed films visually, and also the score is also like incredible. Oh,
and that
well.
And, yeah. and that puts it up with another movie that I think is the same that I thought could have been an Oscar nominee was War of the Gargantuas, just to see.
Well, you're not going to get an argument
for me. To watch without the sound, but it's still
right.
different, but also gorgeous.
Well, they share similar themes of family.
And it's not really a war. It's Spat of the Gargantuas. You know,
yeah, it's Thanksgiving of the Gargantuas. Yeah,
that was an old joke of mine. Was like, what I love most about Frankenstein meets the Wolfman is they don't assume they're going to fight.
Yeah.
Let's have them meet.
See how it goes.
See where it goes.
Yeah. Frankenstein and the Wolfman, drinks.
Not to keep going on, I don't know if it's bad to go on, keep going on the Ari Aster thing,
because
I was yeah. going to talk about Midsommar.
Let's,
but,
right,
know,
let's get into Midsommar.
But that's a fascinating one, because it's like Midsommar is like Hereditary, but that one most people are not on board with. I mm-hmm. get a lot of arguments on that one.
I do
like
it.
It a lot.
I like it a lot.
I've watched the director's cut. I've watched the regular cut. I'm 5.5 hours in to, you know,
right. the main thing.
Swedish Terror.
Yeah.
So funny, because my. Adult female social companion is uh-huh. is Scandinavian.
You're close, are you?
Actually, giving you a special tea.
I don't like girlfriend for people that are over 16.
Right.
You know. And next week she turns 17. Kat is Scandinavian, so
oh,
she
nice.
Knew all about this stuff.
Did she enjoy the movie?
Yeah, I loved it. Loved
I think it. I think it's great. And look. Yeah, if you are, I could see somebody getting upset, like, oh, it's too much like The Wicker Man. Yeah, it's got a lot of Wicker Man in it, but it does its own
identity, though.
But I would completely agree. It has its own thing. And one of the things I really enjoy about that movie is that most of it takes place in broad daylight.
Yeah, that's really interesting. But it's also, that brings up a good point, because I was talking to Patton about The Boys, Derek.
Oh, great.
You know, and I was like, I haven't seen it yet.
Oh, you're going to love this thing.
But to me, it was just like, I can't take more superheroes
sure.
or problems.
Yeah.
And Patton goes, like, it's not what you do. It's how you do it.
Yeah, it's true.
You know? He is 100% right.
Yeah.
And it's like a breath of fresh air.
Yeah.
Because it's also, there's, first of all, it's wonderful casting.
Right.
The cast is flawless.
Yeah.
And then the way that they, there's a, even though there's dark subject matter, there's a lighthearted air to it that, you know, keeps it a little, dare I say, bubbly.
Right.
Uh-huh.
I like The Boys a lot. I'm still sick of superheroes, though. Even as much as I'm enjoying it, I'm still like, yeah, there's fucking superheroes again. Although, The Umbrella Academy, another Netflix thing, that I enjoyed quite a bit.
I struggle with that,
Did
but
you?
I'll go back to it on your recommendation.
Both of those, like The Boys, I have to see. But The Umbrella Academy, I go to, and it was the same with the movie that we were talking about, Little Monsters, which I saw the trailer for last night, which zombies at a kids summer camp with little kids, kind of funny, but I just wouldn't have the balls to walk into the meeting and go, zombies or superheroes. So you're,
right.
How do they keep getting made, but though? It's Patton incredible. Says,
well, yeah, there's another fucking zombie land. It's like, have we not fucked this to death?
Yeah, totally. Yeah. Which brings me to my next film I'd love to talk about, One Cut of the Dead, which is a wonderful zombie film.
Please. I don't know this one.
By the way, Little Monsters could be great. The next Zombieland could be great. But the point that Patton made I was wrong, and he's right, is it's not what you do, it's how you do it.
Sure, yeah.
100%. And that's why movies like Cargo...
Don't argue with me.
No, that's coming.
Oh, yeah.
Cargo, Train to Busan.
Oh, yeah.
You know,
yeah.
those have...
Train to Busan.
I was out. Right. I was checked out of the whole zombie thing, and then those came, and I was like, oh, my God, this is great. And also, Wormwood is awesome. An Australian film. Oh, yeah. My God. I think it's like Road of the Dead or something like that, but it's an Australian flick where the premise is, so zombies, the virus that creates zombies stops machinery from working. And so they figure out the only way to get machines to work is that zombie blood works as gasoline now.
Oh, cool.
And so they've got zombies connected to cars, and then it's Road Warrior-ish.
Right. Oh, that's a great idea.
And there's a lot, and there's more stuff.
Sure.
So
I like that
pure
idea.
Fun.
Hey, cool. Mad Max Fury Road.
Oh my God.
Was
amazing.
Great. My favorite movie.
Yeah.
I think.
I could use.
Talk about, like, you know, the 80s and have those iconic movies. That's one of the only films.
That was also 82, Road Warrior, 82.
Yeah, yeah. And, that's one of the only films in the last decade, Fury Road, that I feel like we're going to be watching this in 20 years.
Yeah, I walked out of that movie elated. Yeah, we rewatched it the other day. Just as great.
I have a criticism of that movie. And that is
nothing happens in
too many girls in it.
Not enough. Not enough Max.
Right.
Not enough character stuff of Max, and also
and not enough gay sex.
And not enough.
That's your criticism of everything.
Once again, I've written slash fiction that apparently nobody's reading. Well,
that's the interesting thing about Mad Max is that Furiosa kind of blows him off the screen, which is.
And it's great. I
got no problem with it.
I do love the movie, but I would also like the one, I still don't think it's as good as The Road Warrior.
No.
Because those are real cars.
But there's a lot of real cars.
There's some real cars, but there's also a lot of like CGI thrown in there that we don't need.
But I don't feel it like calls attention to it.
Sometimes it does, in my opinion.
Yeah, I feel it's a fairly gorgeous film.
I still love it.
I just remember watching The Road Warrior. So with my friends from high school at the drive-in where I worked, and you watch The Road Warrior and you think like, I'd be Mad Max. If this happens, I would be Mad Max.
I know where this is
going.
And
then you see that little guy on the back of the motorcycle and the dog collar, and deep down you're like, that would be me.
Yeah.
I'd be that
I wouldn't
guy.
Even be the snake.
I'd be the comedian at the oil rig.
Yeah.
I think I would have died.
Warrior of the West. The Ayatollah of rock and roller.
Gasoline is in the news.
Right. I would have no fingers or toes by the end of that.
But it is amazing. And you know, Mel Gibson is like, has what Charlize Theron has. And it's like, he's on camera. That's who I'm looking at.
He is great. Sure,
same with a guy I saw last night, Eddie Murphy, who I am such a fan of. I've always been a giant fan of.
Sure.
Yeah.
And did I miss him on screen. And boy, he's on screen and you just can't. But you know who's amazing in Dolemite? Wesley Snipes.
Oh, nice. Good.
Wesley. Right, nice. And he was he's kind of the heavy in the movie. And I was talking to Scott and Larry, like, he just showed up one day. He showed up on the first day and he's like, I'm not going to be the only guy in this movie not getting laughs.
Oh, okay.
And he's hilarious. He's fucking hilarious. And they didn't know what he was going to do.
It seems like it would go well with Bowfinger. I haven't seen it, of course. Don't
it goes? Mind, it, it yeah, like that's it a great. Good, well, it, yeah. It's Ed Wood. I mean, it's just it's a different version. I mean,
Bowfinger. He's just brilliant.
Yeah.
You could argue that Rudy Ray Moore was the Black Ed Wood, and the Dolemite Is My Name is kind of an updated version written by the same people.
Yeah.
It's just beautiful. And but again, like Eddie Murphy, like Mel Gibson, boy, he's on screen. That's who I'm looking at.
Yeah, sure.
And Snipes is terrific in everything.
I've never seen him be this funny before.
Oh, yeah? Okay.
He's fucking hilarious. Yeah, it's such a good movie. It's such a good time. Even though he went crazy later in life,
though he's a piece of shit.
Yeah,
Mel Gibson is. I like him.
Yeah. Hey, you know, if we go down that road, then everybody's an asshole.
That's a difficult one for me because I hate him, but I love his movies. So I'm in the really like.
No, I understand the same way.
And he's an amazing filmmaker.
You know, great director. Yeah. Great director. Yeah. Racist piece of shit said the worst things I've ever heard.
No, he's horrible. He's horrible. He's horrible.
But great. But fucking Braveheart.
Yeah. I mean, Apocalypse. I think is an amazing movie.
Let me go through your record collection and I'll throw out every asshole.
Right. I love John Wayne movies. I don't know what to do with that. Right.
Yeah, exactly. It's just saying I love Clint Eastwood movies. Yeah.
I think that's the thing. He just hit a special level.
Well, I'm not equating
Clint
Eastwood with Mel Gibson.
That Mel Gibson just hit some of the things he said was just so like, the fuck do you come up with something so awful?
This is all I need to know about Mel Gibson. He's a part. He's in the crazy wing of the Catholic Church.
They're not going far enough.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. And I love that he made one of the goriest films of all time, the Passion.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
My mom horror movie. Saw it,
sure.
Which is great. It's like, wow. My mom sat through like 2 hours of just brutal violence.
Yeah. Flat out horror movie.
Amazing.
Yep. People don't realize.
Yep. Flat out horror movie.
Yeah. But he's good at it. He should tackle something like that.
Right.
Like a traditional horror movie.
Yeah, totally.
That'd be cool. Be good.
But I don't want him over.
He's really good friends with somebody I know, and
I hear he's lovely.
He's lovely.
I hear he's lovely.
For the Simpsons, he was great.
But isn't that always the way?
It's always the way. I was, I've done a lot of Bill Maher's show. The two friendliest people I dealt with of the like the big stars are excited to meet Charlton Heston,
okay,
and Michael Medved, the sort of right wing movie critic.
Oh, I didn't know he was a right-wing critic.
Cultural conservative, yeah. Oh,
okay.
Yeah. He goes on, like, the 700 Club.
Sure, yeah.
Oh, okay.
Michael Moore, kind of a dick.
Really?
Yep.
Oh, shit.
I've always heard that.
Yeah. I asked Maxine Waters how I should refer to her, and she went, "You can refer to me as Congresswoman Maxine Waters."
Oh, my God. Jesus.
Go fuck myself. What?
But Heston, though, that's like old Hollywood class.
He was great. He was great. No, he was so friendly and so nice. And I would say argued, but we had disagreements on the panel, and then it was like commercial. Hey, how's it going? Are you working on anything?
That's
like,
great.
I loved it.
I learned something. I just remember this Phil Hendry bit. It was like, that's why Michael Moore is always opening his mouth. He's hoping sandwiches are going to fall in.
It's amazing.
It's amazing. But I do, when he's, speaking about politics, I do usually.
Sure. Oh yeah, 100%.
So again, it's always this crazy mixed bag.
Sure, sure,
I just
totally.
Don't do your thing. I just don't want to hang with you. Right. I like that.
I can't watch Rachel Maddow, and I probably agree with most of what she says. But it's like, you're not Jon Stewart. Stop trying to be Jon Stewart. Right, Jon Stewart's funny. You're not funny. There's nothing wrong with that. Just do what you do and don't be funny.
That's her biggest flaw. Yeah. That and over explaining.
Yeah,
but watching I understand.
Rachel Maddow try to turn a news story into a comedy bit is like watching a 10-year-old boy trying to get laid at an airport bar. It's like,
but I do
to the professionals.
But I do love her, and
of
I do think that she does.
I support.
Like, she has covered a lot of really important stories.
I think one thing is,
I know you're a communist.
That strikes me interesting about the cancel culture that we live in is that some people like somehow get exempt. Like, why? I'm at a restaurant and Michael Jackson is just playing.
I
feel there's been a growth of Michael Jackson.
I said that I was where I was last night and there was playing Michael. And I said to Kat, I said, we've just agreed. Like, but I like his music too much.
Yeah, totally. Exactly.
I like his music too much.
Luckily, I don't.
Oh, okay. All right, there you go.
I stopped at the Jackson 5 and I'm happy right there.
Thriller is a great album.
Chuck Berry.
Right.
Chuck Berry. Oh my God.
Not a gentleman.
I just know.
No references to Chuck Berry. When you go to, if you still go to Brooks Brothers, you can get the etiquette books. What a gentleman does.
Right.
Books. Which I do. I hold the door. I like that.
All right.
Chuck Berry not mentioned in that book.
No. What are the do's and don'ts of golden showers?
I only know the peeping Tom stuff that he used to have a restaurant that he'd peep girls in
he
the
liked
bathroom.
To pee on people.
Oh, he's like,
And there's video.
Yeah. Oh, nice.
Yeah.
And he's not even nice about the peeing.
No, he's not.
He's rude about.
He's rude about
water sports.
Yes.
Yeah, no, it's true. It's true.
From every level, it's horrendous.
It aims right for the eye. Like, what an asshole.
Actually, you hit it right in the eye.
Yeah.
I mean, that is exactly what happens.
Interesting that you would know that. But anyway.
Aim is the most important part.
And you just want to say, Johnny, be good. Johnny, stop peeing.
What did you learn on the Day to Go Halloween special?
It's Halloween.
Yeah,
Chuck
Berry's got great aim.
Scary sports.
When's a great pumpkin coming? Well, funny you should say that. What movie do you have, Matt?
I got one that's it's again. They're always like I'm not picking ones that are this year, but this one I really enjoyed and saw it on I think it was Amazon, called Pie Wacket.
I know Pie Wacket. Yeah.
Pie Wacket is great, and it's this movie that is about this girl and her friends, and they're kind of into the occult and the fun of it, you know, but they're not really that serious. And her mom is going to move this girl away from all her friends. Mm-hmm. And she's so mad at her mom. And the mom is, Lori Holden from The Walking Dead.
Okay.
And, so she gets really mad at her mom, and she finds a real spell to raise a demon to kill her mom.
Mm-hmm.
But then as she does all the stuff, and it takes time for it to happen. But as that's happening, she starts to sort of reconnect with her mom and kind of understand what she's going through.
Oh, that's funny.
And they kind of don't believe really that this thing was going to work anyway.
Right.
But it does.
Oh, that's a great idea.
And it's great.
Yeah, the turn makes it.
Yeah. And there's a lot of great performances. There's a friend of the girls who is part of their little occult group. And stuff starts to happen to the girl, and she starts to notice that the occult, the demonic forces are coming. And she's like, look, I will spend the night with you, and we'll see if this thing is real. And she's kind of laughing it off. And there's this thing where she disappears and comes back, and it's all in the acting. You don't see anything. Mm-hmm. It's just her destroyed. What happened? and she is just a wreck. And that's for me one of the most scariest scenes in the movie.
Right.
And the ending is not exactly, you may see it coming.
Right.
But it's still satisfying. It's a great movie. Mm-hmm. And it's 2000s. Pie Wacket. P-Y-E Wacket.
Right.
Also, 2017.
The name of Kim Novak's familiar in Bell Book and Candle.
Oh, wow.
Is that right?
Damn. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Wow, you are good.
Mm-hmm. Deep cut there.
Yes.
On a similar note to
as opposed to real life, Kim Novak's familiar was named Sammy Davis Jr. much to the chagrin of Harry Kahn.
On a similar note to Pie Wacket, and I believe still on Netflix, I'm not sure, a movie called Dark Song from like about 2 or 3 years ago.
Genius.
Fucking great.
Genius, yeah,
another
that movie.
Small
Dark Song.
A Dark Song. And all it's about is a woman who is craving revenge, and she gets this spiritualist who's going to help her summon a demon to get revenge, and she won't tell you why.
Who's kind of a dick. Yeah.
And so, but it's a month-long process that they're just locked themselves in the house, and they kind of like, you know, he kind of puts her through hell because she has got to go through hell to like
right.
get her revenge to summon these demons. It's great, great movie.
It's great. I mean, talk about also a lot of like left turns that you don't expect.
Yeah, totally.
Amazing performances.
Yeah.
And the ending is kind of beautiful.
Yeah.
It's
and
great.
Little creepy moments. And again, not a scare type movie, but kind of unsettling and kind of nice. Yeah,
like how about this one? This is a favorite of mine that I keep going back to, is The Black Coat's Daughter.
I've seen it, yes.
I love that.
It's a little slow.
But I like the slowness. So it's about, so there's kind of two stories going on. There's one with, there's this girl who's on the run. She's like a runaway, and she befriends James Reamer, and his wife. And James Remar is actually the nice guy in this, you know? And so he's trying to help her. And then you're going back and forth to that story, to another story of these girls who, there's an older girl and a younger girl. And the older girl is the Emma Roberts from, American Horror Story.
Okay.
And then the younger girl is, Kiernan Shipka, Mad Men and
right,
Sabrina.
Yeah, yeah, sure, yeah, yeah.
Yeah. And, so they're left behind at the school and their parents are supposed to pick them up. But, there's this rumor going around that this, in this Catholic school, that the nuns are Satanist.
Mm-hmm.
And
I'm listening.
Yeah. Yeah. But what happens is that there is a possession that goes on with Kiernan Shipka.
Uh-huh.
And there's an exorcism and there's a strange twist in the storyline of the attitude about being possessed that I think is wonderful, and I haven't seen it before. And I think there's a...
It's sort of like they equated to finding Jesus. It's like, I just found a different team.
Kinda. Or maybe missing a friend.
Uh-huh. Sure, yeah.
You know?
That was a funny thing I read the other day. It was like, Satan... The people in the Church of Satan don't really believe in Satan.
No.
And so I was like, then who does? Hey, Christians.
Christians, yeah, totally. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Their, their whole thing is, if you like ice cream, eat a bunch.
Right, right. Do what thou wilt. Yeah, 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 yeah.
And now... tale well calculated to keep you in suspense.
It is one of the coolest, creepiest movies ever made. It's Night of the Living Dead before Night of the Living Dead. It's a David Lynch movie before there were David Lynch movies. 1962's low-budget gem, Carnival of Souls. And it owes its existence to the intersection of two very strange things, the Russian satellite Sputnik and the Mormon Church's need to party. On October 4th, 1957, Americans learned that the Soviet Union had successfully launched the first man-made satellite into space. It was dubbed Sputnik, and it prompted a national panic, not simply over the looming Cold War, but over the fear that came with the realization that the Soviet Union had beaten the United States. They beat us into space. And this led, naturally, to panic and hysteria. And the finger of blame was pointed directly at the American educational system, which had failed to produce a group of scientists that could beat the Ruskies into space. This resulted in the National Defense Education Act, signed into law by President Eisenhower in 1958. Spurred by the fear that the Soviet Union had eclipsed American scientists, the NDEA poured $1 billion into American schools, specifically with an eye towards a new, reinvigorated approach to teaching American school children science. Now, one of the ways in which the brave new world of science was introduced to American students was the then novel Educational Film. Now, educational films predate the Sputnik launch, making their first appearance in the late 1940s, but it was the National Defense Education Act that put the companies who made these films into big, permanent business. Anybody who attended a public school prior to the 2000s has seen an educational film, whether it was explaining how volcanoes were formed or showing you how different animals survive in the winter. Prior to this, these films had far more ambitious goals, drifting as they did into the realm of social engineering. You would go to school, sit in a classroom, and a film would be shown that would tell you how to think and how to behave. Such films as How to Date, The Angry Boy, or How to Control Your Emotions. And naturally, Molly grows up.
Hi, what kind of a day did you have today?
Mom, guess what?
I don't know. What?
Mom, I started my first period.
Well, what do you know? Come on, sit down. Tell me about it.
A full discussion of these films is certainly warranted and will be dealt with at a later date, as well as how Molly turned out. But for now,
we have bigger fish to fry. Educational films, by and large, were made by four major companies: the Learning Corporation of America, Encyclopedia Britannica Films, and a company called Coronet Films. Last and least was a scrappy little company called Centron Films. Founded in Lawrence, Kansas, Centron stood for Central, meaning Lawrence, Kansas, the middle of the country, and Electronic, as in the electronic age of the future. Centron made movies like Halloween Safety and the What Happens If You Get VD classic, The Innocent Party.
It isn't the end of the world for you. We can cure syphilis, especially if we find it in the early stages, such as yours.
I don't know how I got it. I haven't done anything.
Don, let's be straightforward about this. I'm not here to make a moral judgment, but you and I know that it was contracted through sexual intercourse with an infected person.
The Innocent Party was directed by Centron's in-house auteur, Herc Harvey. Now, at some point, late in 1960, Herc Harvey was driving back to Lawrence, Kansas after directing a Centron movie in California. As he drove through Salt Lake City in Utah, he saw what was left of the Saltaire Pavilion. The Saltaire Pavilion, which resembles a brooding Moorish castle, was built by the Mormon Church on the shores of the Great Salt Lake in 1893. It was intended as a family destination, a safe, wholesome atmosphere under the open supervision of Mormon church leaders. You see, other resorts in the area were viewed by the church as being spiritually bleak. But a young, courting Mormon couple could visit Saltaire and have a big, heaping helping of hardcore wholesomeness right out in the open. Saltaire was a place where God's children could frolic within the boundaries of God's law, which makes one wonder why God let it burn to the ground in 1925. But so it goes. Saltaire was rebuilt and, in 1931, almost burned to the ground again. But it was repaired. But then the Great Salt Lake receded, and it was left standing on 2,000 pilings over a bunch of stinky wet sand and rotting fish. Fun fact, the Pixies song Palace of the Brine is about Saltaire. But it was this abandoned, decaying, spooky yet creepy structure that Herc Harvey drove past at dusk on his lonely drive back home to Lawrence from Los Angeles. And he thought to himself, gee, that'd be a great place to make a horror movie. So he went home and spoke to John Clifford, who wrote many of Centron's movies, and said, hey, I want you to write a horror movie. And all I care about is that it ends with a bunch of dead people coming out of the Great Salt Lake, and they gotta dance around this big abandoned pavilion. And John Clifford said, okay, and went to work. What would emerge from this collaboration would come to be considered a cult classic, but not right away. Carnival of Souls was shot over three short weeks for a budget of only $33,000, paltry by even 1961 standards. It begins like a Centron-made red asphalt automobile safety film. Young Mary Henry, played by Candace Hillegas, is driving with her friends when they succumb to temptation and take part in an ill-advised street race. In short order, their car plummets off a nearby bridge into a river, and when it is finally fished out, all of the occupants are dead. All except for Mary. Mary tries to go on with her life. Or does she? She moves to Utah, where she's been hired as a church organist. Though, and this is rare for 1962, Mary casually professes to be not very religious.
Well, Mary, you'll make a fine organist for that church. Be very satisfying to you, I think.
It's just a job to me.
Well, it's not quite the attitude for going into church work.
I'm not taking the vows. I'm only going to play the organ.
Once Mary hits the road for Utah, the existential shit hits the fan. She finds herself being followed by a strange, pale, cadaverous-looking man, known only in the credits as The Man, and played by director Herc Harvey. The film reveals one of its biggest influences here, The Hitchhiker, by Lucille Fletcher, who also wrote Sorry, Wrong Number. The Hitchhiker was done as an episode of the radio series Suspense, starring Orson Welles, and was later adapted by Rod Serling for The Twilight Zone. Mary makes it to Utah, where, like Herc Harvey, she finds herself inexplicably drawn to the Saltaire Pavilion. Unlike Herc Harvey, she suffers strange lapses of, well, reality. It suddenly seems that she's invisible to those people around her, In one quietly terrifying scene, she's in a department store trying on dresses. And she can't hear anybody speak. And they can't hear her. Nor see her. No one except for the cadaverous, mysterious man. After this episode, Mary becomes obsessed with the question of whether or not she is actually still alive. This is an existential crisis of massive proportions. And as you would imagine, would have a deleterious effect on one's career as a church organist.
Profane! Sacrilege! What are you playing in this church? Have you no respect? Do you feel no reverence? And I feel sorry for you and your lack of soul.
Things go from bad to worse for poor Mary until she finds herself wandering the Saltaire Pavilion, all by herself. Or is she? You have to see it. Carnival of Souls didn't make much of a splash when it was first released. It played mostly in drive-ins on a double bill with a film called The Devil's Messenger. But it never went away, popping up on TV consistently, and around 1989, as Twin Peaks and David Lynch fever hit in a big way, Carnival of Souls made a comeback, being as it was a David Lynch film made before David Lynch started making films. I think he cited it in an interview, and things went from there. Carnival of Souls is a great little movie. Made on a shoestring and not enough time, it nonetheless looks amazing because Herc Harvey and the Centron crew knew what they were doing. Story-wise, it's a neat little cousin to The Hitchhiker or An Occurrence at Owl Creek Bridge. I heartily recommend it. Now, should you choose not to watch it?
I feel sorry for you and your lack of soul.
Nut thinks he is a vampire. He has killed 4, maybe 5 women. He has drained every drop of blood from every one of them. Now that is news, Vincenzo. News. And we are a newspaper. We are supposed to print news, not suppress it.
Call Jack, you are an idiot.
Speaking of San Francisco, Anton LaVey used to live around the corner from...
That's
Alex,
right.
Alex Reed's in my apartment.
Did you guys go in?
I see him near the laundromat. He lived near our laundromat.
Did you ever go over and like?
No, but he had that
borrow a cup of Satan.
Yeah. No, but he had that black Victorian, and then he was like, you know, he was just an old guy.
Did he ever? Was it true?
Stain in my hood.
Yeah, basically. Wash it, you know, just an old guy. Yeah. He looked kind of like Sid Haig by that. God rest his soul.
I went as him for Halloween like 2 years ago.
God rest his soul.
Do you know what tigers eat?
Do you know the difference between a crow and a raven? Because I can't go back in the house until I know.
I'm not going to be the laughing stock again.
Who logged you out of your house? It's a crow or a raven. I don't know.
But I really like that movie because I think it's a slow build.
Right.
And you might think that's a fair comment on this movie. But I think it's great.
I'll go really fast here. I mentioned
but
a movie I am crazy over the moon about that I can't say enough good things about. Again, from our friends at Shudder. I swear I don't work for them. One Cut of the Dead, a Japanese film that is it's a zombie film all in one shot. But here's the thing. I can't tell you much about it.
I've heard of it.
Because it has such twists in it that this is the only thing I'll say about it. That when you watch the first half hour the first time, you'll feel one way about it. But when you're done with it, you will feel completely different about what you saw in the first half hour.
All right.
Oh, interesting. And it's all one. It's like Rope, but it's a...
Kind of, yeah. I don't want to ruin too much about it, but all I can say is you may be kind of, I don't know about this, the first 30 minutes, but then just keep going. And holy shit, it's fucking fantastic.
Japanese?
Japanese. And it really...
Them and the Korean horror movies are so good.
Yeah. And I also recommend it. It's not necessarily a great horror film, but funny enough, it becomes a great we can do it team movie. And it makes... It's a real feel-good film, funny enough. You will be happy, really happy by the end of this film.
There was Japanese or Korean. It came out last year. Basically, the story is basically La Femme Nikita.
Okay.
A young woman kind of lost. She gets brought into this school. She's trained to be an assassin. She's a professional actress.
Movie?
That's her cover. Yeah.
I know.
And the first, I can't remember the name. It's like The Fiance or something. I can't remember the name of it. God damn it. It's so good. And the first.
It's not The Villainous, right?
I don't think so.
Okay,
but I'll check.
I hear a lot of good things about that. But
the first attack is one shot.
Oh,
it's
all
POV
right.
Going through like this drug lord's headquarters. And it's, I watched it like looking for the cuts.
That's the thing. And I think that's what Blear, and it's certainly if you're in the entertainment industry or involved in making movies, I recommend the movie all the more because there, it is one of the most technically impressive and how anybody can keep track. And again, I don't want to say much, but there are several layers of stuff going on that are all in sync all happening, not to mention the camera that's catching it all. And then there's amazing behind the scenes of then you have the behind the scenes crew catching the camera when, and it's also about a film crew. So, so it's like three levels deep of
you know, I love that
film
stuff.
Crews. And,
I
and
love
it's
that
just
stuff.
Like how you guys conceived of this, planned this, rehearsed this.
Yeah.
Oh my God. It's amazing.
I loved it.
It's probably one of my favorite films of the year, just period. You know.
Wow. Okay.
So The Villainous?
Wow. No, I'm sorry. I want One Cut of the Dead.
Okay, One Cut of the Dead.
Okay. Okay. We've all seen Mandy, right?
Yeah, of course.
Mandy is amazing. Yeah. And which is like you know, this Nicolas Cage thing that goes into like almost a fantasy world.
Right.
But it's so beautiful.
Like the rest of his gritty reality.
well, there's another movie that came out around the same time, which is kind of a guilty pleasure of mine. I wouldn't say it's like one of the best movies ever made, but it sure was a lot of fun. And that's Mom and Dad.
Yeah.
Mom and Dad is great fun.
Yeah. I don't think that movie gets enough credit.
I agree.
A lot of fun.
I agree.
Yeah, Selma Blair's fun in it. Nicolas Cage is fun
in it.
She's
terrific. Yeah. She really grounds that thing.
Yeah, totally. Yeah. Really. Lance Hendrickson. There's a lot of really just great stuff in that film.
Now, people confuse those two movies too because they both came out on the same time.
Yes.
Right.
Yeah. They're both similar genres.
Yeah. And Mom and Dad has just got the best premise ever, which is all of a sudden parents want to kill their children.
Right.
And it's great. They don't want to.
That's not a fictional premise. Yeah.
Right.
But and they don't want to kill any children. They only want to kill their children.
Right.
And that's what's great because they're doing all this and then the grandparents show up and then that adds another level of
it. That's a lot of fun. I really enjoyed it. I don't think that enough people were talking about that when it came out. Everyone went crazy over Mandy and I love Mandy.
I love Mandy.
I agree that this was another really good Nicolas Cage movie that was a lot of fun.
Super fun.
I just saw his most recent one, which is The Color Out of Space, the Lovecraft.
Any good?
It's okay.
Is it faithful?
Yes.
Was this a Shutter viewing? Where did you see most of these
things? I saw that at Beyond Fest. I was at the opening night of Beyond Fest. It was a Spectre Vision double feature. And it's cool. It's a return of Richard Stanley who did Hardware.
Right, sure.
Yeah. And he hasn't made a movie in like 30 years. And it was cool, you know.
Well, he tried to make
a movie.
Oh, right. Yes, exactly. Yes, totally.
Richard Stanley, as we've talked about him on this podcast, he was the original director of the remake of Island of Dr. Moreau.
Right.
With Val Kilmer and Marlon Brando, both at their height of fuck me, fuck you.
Right. There's so many fascinating stories on that because it's, you know,
it broke him.
Yeah. He got fired and then he started dressing up as one of the animals and the creatures in the background.
He didn't leave the island.
Yeah. No, he went off into the forest and then came back as an extra.
There's a brilliant documentary called The Lost Journey of Richard.
That's Lost Soul, I thought.
Lost Soul, yeah, it's just
he's a fascinating dude. I've spent time with Richard Stanley. He doesn't blink.
Yeah,
he just will stare at you, and he doesn't blink. And
that's
unnerving. But I like him. He's a very sweet man. He's very lovely. Yeah. He'll read your tarot cards. He's a lovely, lovely human being.
Yeah,
but
and I really think that movie is more entertaining than people give it credit for. The Island of Dr. Moreau.
Well, it's one of those movies where it's like now you have to watch the documentary. With the movie, it's like Hearts of Darkness and Apocalypse Now.
I would
Plan 9 and Ed Wood. You have to see them both.
I would watch any movie with Marlon Brando and a dwarf. so it doesn't matter. They could have spun that off into their own show. I would watch every episode.
And that guy's a dick. Like the dwarf.
The dwarf?
Movie,
I didn't know that.
He turned into a massive asshole because Marlon Brando was protecting him. So he was like, he could do anything he wanted. And he just started walking up to people on the set and punching them in the balls because he knew he couldn't get fired.
This is my revenge for all the pain and torment. Big people have given me.
Every time someone picked me up.
Right. Exactly, yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah. Now, just, you know, what did you, the big release, like, what did you think of it?
Now, I've not seen the second part.
Uh-huh.
So I go to you guys. Is it any good? Because I was lukewarm on the first one.
I feel I like the first one quite a bit.
I enjoyed it, but it's nothing I would ever really want to see again.
This was the bloated version of the first one.
Yeah, okay. This is the Hobbit. Yeah, like, and unfortunately, it's hobbled by the ending of the book.
What pissed me off about it, because it's a close to 3-hour runtime or 2-hour 40 minutes or something like that, is I thought we had an unwritten deal here. I thought the first one was about the kids.
Yeah.
And the second one was about the adults, and I thought we were going to keep it to that. Uh-huh. But then some executive said, yeah, but people love the kids. We got to have the kids back. Yeah. Bring the kids back.
Yeah.
And so now...
Are the kids their kids?
Now we get new flashbacks that are an addition to the other thing. Oh, remember that other time a big scary thing came bumbling out and scared them and they ran away. And then they repeat it again as adults. And you can only do that gag so many times. So after about the 17th one of something shambling out, and a lot of them are stupid. Like a giant Paul Bunyan statue is just not scary.
But see, that was my problem with the first one, is that I felt like there were some great scares in
there. Ghostbusters 3.
Right? Yeah, I mean, that's kind of what it felt like, yeah.
But like the first one, there were so many like scare scenes with the clown that they kept coming too quickly. And everything was made to look too spooky. Like house is like, you know, the monsters all of a sudden in the middle of it. And it's just like, enough.
Well, if that was enough,
yeah.
If that was enough, let's double it for you. Times two.
Oh, no.
And it had good moments. I mean, it definitely has
moments. I'm going to see it.
And the great visuals, and this is a weird way to break it down. I felt any time there was something scary that was small, it was effective, but there's a lot of like big creatures, and that's stupid.
Although I did like in the first one where he comes out of the movie screen, like that was I thought that was pretty cool.
There's some really good shit, and there's some good shit in this one, but it's too much. There's too much movie in this.
Well, again, like, you know, comedies and horror movies are cousins. And, you know, they're always better lean and mean.
Yeah.
You know, it's very rare.
And speaking of, there's another thing that's odd about this movie is that it also, which I didn't feel happened in the first one, it leans very much into comedy. And there are odd comedic moments
that come
out of nowhere.
Well, Bill Hader plays a comedian.
Well, but then that's fine. That's his character and that works. But there's
he wasn't in the book. He's a screenwriter in the book.
Is he?
I don't remember.
He's a writer, yeah.
Yeah, okay. That's not a good...
But there's some moment where this thing is vomiting blood on somebody, and then they, like, cut a music cue to, like, just call me Angel.
Yeah.
And it's just like, what the fuck was that? So weird, you know?
Well, the whole story is hobbled by the ending of that book, which is insane.
Right, sure.
It's like...
I never got to the end.
I gotta end this book.
Yeah.
There's been a mini series. There's been the book. We could say
it's a giant spider from outer space.
Yeah, you know. So
from outer space.
Yes, exactly.
So. It's a giant spider. Matt. It's a giant spider.
There's only one giant spider movie for me, and that's Big Ass Spider.
Thank you very much. Mm-hmm. Thank you. That's
by the way, if I may compliment you one more time about that movie, I think that movie works so well as a horror comedy, but also that. One of the things you do that I got so mad about with Godzilla, this latest Godzilla movie, King of the Monsters, is that you show the spider in broad daylight.
Right, sure. Mm-hmm. Like Midsummer, man.
And it's creepy, but it works. Yeah. It's creepy.
You have the best guess.
Sure. I agree completely.
But and so, hey, Godzilla guys, you know, maybe a little less smoke.
Guys who are huge Godzilla fans,
yes,
how did you feel about that film?
I thought it was not great.
Right.
I felt bad for the actors in it, because
it's amazing how they make like great actors be terrible.
Yeah.
And just like how'd you do that?
Stuff is like a sketch. Like, this is all about Ricky. It's like there's a giant monster stepping on the building you're in. This is like an SCTV sketch.
Well, also, I like in that movie too. Like, because I did enjoy a lot of the monsters.
Watch him fight. Just let him fight. But hey, straining at the bit to create a universe
right,
of this
sure, yeah.
Monster League or something. Just stop it.
Right.
You know, it's like, how can we make a movie if we can't also make 37 other movies?
Right.
Just make a movie.
Just make a fucking movie.
And also, could people get farther away from the pit where the monster's going to come out of? Can people, you know, like there's a lot of, everyone in that movie has cancer, right?
Yeah,
we can all agree that no one is coming out of that movie alive.
Yeah.
Everybody is, their face is right in
we
plumes of,
we know
right.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's no way.
It's just like, who are we to say? I'm sure it made a good $1 trillion, but
not really. It was a bit of a disappointment.
It was a bit.
I know it's probably, you know, it's probably bad signs for King Kong versus Godzilla too, because it's like, oh, we greenlit that, did we?
Shin Godzilla?
Shin Godzilla is fantastic.
Shin Godzilla is genius.
Like, well, I'm curious.
But again, it's just like, you know what'd be great? King Kong versus Godzilla? It's between 90 minutes and 2 hours.
Right.
And it's a lot of fighting.
Yeah. I love Kong Skull Island. That was great.
I enjoyed that. Yeah.
That was a lot of fun.
It's all people want.
I'm curious as I am a passive Godzilla fan. I like the, I like the little miniatures. And
how
I like the
dare you.
I know. You guys are the diehards. So when I was a
That's
kid.
That's why we're getting late.
It might be. So when
G-Fest is my bitch.
So when I was a kid, I would love all the monster parts and be really into it. And then it would cut to Japanese scientists talking and I'd get bored and I'd want to change the channel. And this movie felt actually very much like that to me. So I was wondering if there's any chance you feel the movie was actually kind of too faithful, that it actually was almost like, hey, we're going to like follow those formulas.
You can't do that. You know, there was a reason why they were the way they were when they were made.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Okay. It reflected a time.
Yeah.
And to use that as an excuse that you made a shitty movie. Right. It's not an homage. It's just a shitty movie.
Yeah, structurally, it was similar, but at the same time, I agree. It's like, we don't have to adhere to that.
You know what?
We could make them fun characters.
Monster Zero is a way better written movie than that one.
Yeah.
Right.
It's just, know what movie you're making.
Yeah.
It's called Godzilla.
Because I know there was tons of Easter eggs that were lost upon me, you know. Because
me too. I mean, I just like.
I mean,
I know
they kind of, you know, the Mothra twins are referenced.
Yeah,
you know,
the peanuts are referenced, but very briefly.
But you know, and then that I thought was kind of silly too. You know, it's just like, just if you're gonna do it, do it.
Yeah, if you're gonna do it, do it. And
right,
they just they need it to be important. And
it was one of those typical it doesn't.
It's,
I enjoyed all the monster
movie.
Stuff, just did not like.
I love Ghidorah.
Humans, you
know? Yeah,
Ghidorah's heads fighting each other. I love that. I thought that was inspired.
Yeah, just cut all the people out.
Cut the people
out. It's probably good. It's true, but it's sort of like, you know. Dawn of the Planet of the Apes. The apes are great people.
Right. Yeah, totally.
Yeah.
The apes are amazing.
How about older ones? Older Halloween movies?
I've never seen any. I don't know.
I mean, when I think of a movie that sort of encapsulates the mood of Halloween, I'd have to go right to Horror Hotel.
Oh.
Otherwise known as City of the Dead.
All right.
And that movie, you know, it's all about, there's this woman who is studying the occult. Her teacher sends her to this town where supposedly it's overrun by witches.
Right.
And she goes there.
Is this Amica? Who made this?
This is actually
not Hammer.
It was. I think it was released by Vulcan. It's actually a company called Vulcan.
Christopher Lee's
but
in it.
Christopher Lee's in it. But because it was Milton Sabotsky, I believe it was their first Amicus movie.
Okay, all right, yeah.
That was Amicus. And talk about mood, and like, it's everything that you want out of a Halloween movie. There's smoke and atmosphere and, you know, contrast all over the place and creepy little scenes, and it's a tiny little movie. I'm sure it was done on three sets.
Oh yeah, no, it's completely one of the movies that there's a maze at Universal. There's a Frankenstein meets the Wolfman maze at Universal Studios this year, which is very sweet. Although it's weird because it's not it's the Benicio del Toro Wolfman fighting some new kind of Frankenstein. It's not really the classic, but
But I like that it delves into the
gypsies. I do too. Yeah.
And, you know,
yes. Like, 100%.
As long as it's not the De Niro one.
No. But Frankenstein Meets the Wolfman is a crazy movie. And it was made in the early 40s, like 43, I think. And the lead in the movie is, it's a story about a guy who is trying to commit suicide and can't. That's the story. He's like, Lon Chaney Jr. is walking around the whole movie going, I just want to die. Right. Can't you help me die? Will somebody help me? It was really dark and really crazy when you, when you look back at it as an adult.
He's so really good.
He's so good in that
at
movie.
At that role.
Yeah, he was amazing in
as
that
Lawrence
role,
Talbot, he was always perfectly spot on
great
in every movie.
And the other crazy thing in that movie is the festival of the wine, this giant like 10 minute in the middle of the like this crazy gypsy wine festival.
Did we like we were so scared that we needed that brief breather? You know, like wine festival. Finally, I can catch my breath. Oh,
you know, what's an interesting thing for people if you go back and watch it. One thing to look for is that Bela Lugosi, who turned down Frankenstein originally, as discussed in Ed Wood. He plays Frankenstein's monster and he had dialogue and it sounded so laughably bad. They just cut it all, but there are still scenes where if you watch it, he's moving his lips and no dialogue's coming out. It's really cobbled
and together. By that movie, the Frankenstein monster
an old man by that movie too.
By that movie, I believe the Frankenstein monster was blind, right?
Yes. Well, he was blind because, here we go. In the previous movie, Ghost of Frankenstein, the character of Igor, played by Bela Lugosi, and he's great in it. Mm-hmm. He's great as Igor.
Genius.
They put his brain into Frankenstein. The brain, for some reason, everything worked but the eyesight. Everything else worked great.
Oops.
But that's why they go, well, then he sounds like him, so he should have Igor's voice, which doesn't track at all. You don't take on the voice of the person whose brain you have, that as it may.
But that is why you now get, when someone is doing their stereotypical Frankenstein impression, that's why you get the arms outreached and the kind of, because he's a blind man. He's a blind man walking around.
Oh, that's
scary.
True.
Yeah,
right. Yeah,
that's
Yeah, that's true. He doesn't, because in the other, Boris Karloff doesn't do that.
No, he's pretty spry in those first three.
Well, Frankenstein can't get a good brain. Man.
He cannot get
for love or money.
Yeah,
then it's the hunchback weirdo. I mean, it's true. Know, it's just he can't
Abby Normal.
A break.
Yeah.
I think we
gave him Hugh Jackman's brain. Hot knock your overcoat when the wind is free.
Now that movie I'd watch.
I wanted to
sort of young Frankenstein.
Yeah,
the Lou Costello.
Yeah.
He would have had a simple life. Simple,
bullying asshole.
Which I believe playing at the New Bev this Halloween
season.
Oh,
is it really?
Yeah. It's one of the matinees. Costello Meet Frankenstein.
I gotta get that calendar. Yeah. Again, we're talking about, like, I just remember, like, movies that you watch now, still a great movie, but nowadays, the studio would go, it's too slow, is Young Frankenstein.
Oh, yeah. So
there
great.
Are some scenes in Young Frankenstein, they go like, let's go to the castle.
Right.
And the studio goes, no, there needs to be a joke there. You can't end a scene without a giant joke.
All right,
go
sure.
crazy. But, like, that movie plays pretty great.
Still so good. Still holds
so good.
Yeah. So what is everyone watching this Halloween? What is the movie that?
Well, Tales of Halloween.
Of course, yes. That's a classic. That's how you should start.
Creep Show, of course.
Sure.
I always have to put on Mario Bava's Black Sabbath.
Uh-huh. Nice. I put that in Horror Hotel in the same kind of.
Yeah, I mean, again, mood. I mean, Mario Bava could, you know.
Yeah, the Drop of Water one is my.
The Drop of Water one is brilliant.
I made a movie called Grave Dancers. That was the whole inspiration. It's I just want.
I love
ghosts.
That movie too, by the way.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, it's like I just want those creepy, like smiley, freaky ghosts.
It's such a simple story because there's three stories in Black Sabbath's anthology movie, but that one is. There's a maid who's taking care of this medium who dies and gets this woman to come over and help her with the body. And the medium has this ring that the woman who comes over to help kind of covets, takes the ring, goes home, and now the spirit of that medium is terrorizing her. And it's such a simple effect. It's like this, almost like, I think it's a mannequin. Mm-hmm. but with this just horrific grimace.
Oh, see, I know yeah, that. Yeah,
and yeah. it's floating around. And I yeah, just, I yeah. saw that as a kid on Creature Features in San Francisco. Uh-huh. And I remember like, this shouldn't be allowed. Like, this is too scary. Great movie. And then the rest of the movie's great too. The word or lack is, yeah. I love.
Even in a movie me, yeah. that is, I really enjoy, House on Haunted Hill, the way that woman yeah. with that same face, but the way they just pull her on a
yeah, that's a good yeah. moment.
It's a really, yeah, it's a great moment.
Yeah, it's really simple, moment. But it's
great
so
simple
good.
Effect.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. yeah. it really works.
Yeah. yeah.
I just pull her along.
That one has a. That one's not necessarily a scary movie, but it
no,
it's fun. It has delightful. A lot of mood.
Yeah, it's delightful.
Know? Yeah. I love
some
that.
Of you are going to come to my house.
Yeah, that's great.
I would also. I also usually watch two separate Roddy McDowall movies:
Poseidon Adventure and Lord Love a Duck.
And I just watch his scenes.
Yeah, I watch the cool ones.
And... Well, my guilty pleasure, of course, is the Golem movie.
I'm gonna. Can I guess the two that you watch?
Yeah,
Legend of Hell House and Fright Night.
There you go.
Oh, those
both
nice.
Of those
are good ones.
Both of those are
the Night Gallery pilot. Oh, Portify.
I love that Portify. Though.
Yeah, that's a good one, though.
That's yeah, a great one. That's a really good anthology film, yeah, it is just on its own. Yeah, yeah. But
Fright Night's a classic.
That Fright Night is so good. That is a tour de force for Halloween. Oh, you get yeah, everything in that one,
yeah. Yeah.
And the practical effects yeah. are just
that weird kid. Like, that weird kid that didn't look much,
Evil Ed.
Evil Ed who didn't look much different when he was a monster than from when he was
right. Sure, sure. Yeah, yeah.
Amanda Bierce, her last, yep. I think.
Was it Billy Ragsdale? Is he that?
Yeah, yes. Yeah. But I love that thing, and that's another one where the comedy. And
yeah,
the horror works really well.
Such a good
very
film.
80,
yeah.
like very.
Yes.
It's like the
Hollywood. But in the best charming way.
I say that in a positive yeah, way, yeah. yeah. No, it's like the horror movie equivalent to Valley Girl.
Right.
Like, it's like, yeah. this is yeah. what, this was what, Fright Night's 85, I think.
That's
yeah.
Right, yeah.
Yeah. It's like, this is what 1985 was. Valley Girl, this is what 1982 and 83 was.
Right.
You know, like, funk. Yeah. This is it.
Yeah. yeah. We had Tom Holland on our show, and he just went through and how much of a joy that thing was to make and how they really left him alone. And
really?
That's why it's as good as
that's
it is.
Yeah, right.
And then, you know, you've got all these practical effects that are like, it's like at the heyday.
Yeah.
Yeah, it is. Yeah,
there's
it
really so is, many yeah. great
and there's
practical
a big
effects.
80s horror documentary coming out that I
yeah,
saw.
My buddy,
on Sunday,
my buddy
believe,
David
yeah.
Weiner, we're going to go to the premiere. You guys should come.
Is it right. On Sunday?
On Sunday, yeah, yeah. Yeah. David Weiner, who used to be the editor of Famous Monsters of Filmland.
Oh, really?
Lovely guy.
Sunday night?
Yeah. At 6:00. It's a 4-hour
yeah,
documentary.
Say, someone yeah. told me it was
it's
a 4-hour documentary, yeah. and I'm like, oh, you lost me there.
I'm doing something with my daughter that neither one of us wants to do.
Uh-oh, here we go.
For school. I mean, you'd think it'd be great. I'll cut this. She has a music appreciation class, and she has to go see a concert.
Oh, okay.
So I was like, and she's running out of time.
What kind of like a symphony or
something? Something jazz or classical.
Okay,
and so we're going to the one thing that at least I could sit through because I could not sit through a classical. We're going to see Van Morrison at the Hollywood Bowl.
Oh,
that'll be good.
That'll but be
she
good.
She loves the moon dance, you know.
It's like, yeah, and Scientology.
$400 fucking bucks.
Is it really? Are you serious?
Yeah, $200. Oh. Yeah, about that. Just
I mean, that's what I pay for shows that I want to see, but yeah. not for fucking Van Morrison. At the
well, yeah, it's like it's $175 a piece.
The Rolling Stones were like $300 a piece. So that's
right.
why
well,
I'm
this
like,
is
I'm
for
like,
both of us. This is for both of us.
Yeah. Okay.
Well, 400. Yeah, I know, but that's yeah. just what
that's
I'm saying.
That's a lot.
Like, I, you know,
not for a goddamn
no, it's a lot. That's what I'm saying. Like, most of the top notch stuff is like right. close to that. So I'm a little surprised that, yeah. you know.
We're going to see Kiss okay. in March.
At the Bowl?
No, in Oakland. Because oh, really? That was one of the, at the time that we bought the tickets, they postponed the show. But at the time, it was like one of the last, like, ones where
oh,
I could
God.
Get to.
I could right. go to that. I'd go to that.
You should go. I'm telling you, I got tickets through Jeff Wills.
Oh, okay.
Oh, yeah. You know, I've never, ever. It's so funny. Our friend Jeff Wills, who used to manage the Punchline in San Francisco.
Lovely guy.
The nicest guy in the world. And now he's one of the, like, the president of Live Nation.
Yeah,
or
yeah.
Oh,
great.
Yeah. He showed me around. It was beautiful.
I've never called him for anything. Okay.
Well, the last time I called him for a concert ticket favor was when Kiss put the makeup back on the first
sure.
time.
Nice, nice.
And so it was great. It was nice to hook up with him again. And,
yeah,
you
he's
know,
a lovely guy.
He's a great nice guy. He was great. And, you know, he made it all happen. And we have these tickets that are like in their little batch of, I don't even know where they are, but I'm right, sure they're going to be great. The last time that we went, when we saw Kiss, I was so close to the stage that I could feel the fire right, yeah. from Gene
so
Simmons.
Close to the stage, light on you.
So close yeah. to the stage you were in cat makeup.
Yeah.
Someone put me on a wire and yeah. I flew around. Yeah. It was liberating.
I've seen them a dozen times or something like that.
Oh,
not because I'm a fan.
No,
but no, I swear to God. I mean,
no,
I,
of course.
I enjoy
it's
them.
Kiss, of course.
And I think they're fun.
Yeah.
But
their songs
but
are very catchy.
Yes, but this, my ex-wife used
0%
to,
wrong with
my
them.
Ex-wife used to dress the Simmons family for the TV show.
Oh, okay.
And so we were friends with the Simmons
sure.
family.
Oh my
so,
God.
So
wow.
we would go often.
My God.
But I've seen enough Kiss to last yeah, a lifetime, yeah, okay. I feel.
Well, know, this is supposedly...
Mike, kiss hat.
Kissarmy.com.
I thought you were going to give me one. No, you can order it at kissarmy.com.
Yeah.
But I'm in your house.
Have you seen that meme where like it's it, and there's a little gutter, and Georgie's looking in, and Gene Simmons is popping out. He's like, hey, Georgie, want to buy some merch? That's about like yeah, I have so
great.
Many Gene Simmons stories, but I can't say them
oh.
here. But
that's all right. I can't wait.
You want to kiss Pinball Machine?
Yeah, yeah.
This could be the last time, is what they say. At least
I mean it. Probably they've been I mean, doing it. They've been on the farewell tour for about 15 years.
See, I was going to go see the Who coming up, but I'm like, what if I wait them out and maybe I'll get them one more time without a fucking symphony orchestra behind them?
Oh, is that what it is?
Yeah, it's them with an orchestra
behind them.
These
guys are getting up there, though. You know, that was
75.
That was the thing with the Rolling Stones. Like, yeah, they just played Pasadena, and I've never seen them before, and I really wanted to go. But at this point, you're getting them on StubHub, and they're like $400 each.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and it was like, Jesus Christ, do I spend $800 to see the Rolling Stones? But it's in that caveat of like, you're never going to see them again.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, you got to go now, you know. So
it's always a little weird.
Under my...
look, I heard he was great. I heard he was jumping in and, doing the thing.
No, these guys are ageless.
Yeah.
I saw Paul McCartney at the Dodger Stadium.
Oh, that was
awesome.
I was there.
Yeah.
Oh,
you were there, too.
Yeah, yeah.
Saw a Beatles reunion.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was incredible.
And it was the guy singing. He was on stage for 3 hours.
Yeah.
He took 2 sips of water.
Yeah.
And he never sweat.
I saw him 10 years ago and I saw him now. I would say he's slowed down a little bit, but just like 15%, you know, like, you know, I think he was a little spryer 10 years ago, but still amazing. That was
amazing. Yeah.
Sometimes it's a little teeter totter of sometimes whether I want to see somebody, especially when I see them in this one light of when I discovered them.
Yeah. Of course.
And then to see them older, like
I was at the Paul Anka show.
That would be fine. That would be fine. Yeah. But like, I saw the Buzzcocks before Pete Shelley died and hung out backstage with them and they were great. But like, you know, you look at the old pictures of the Buzzcocks, everybody's like, you know, a rail.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
And then it's like, and then all of a sudden it's like two of your uncles.
Yeah.
Or, you know, on stage doing "Ever Fallen in Love," but you know,
yeah,
and it's just it's weird.
I see that now when I see Billy Zoom sitting. Billy Zoom comes out and sits on the stool. Still plays amazing. It's like,
all right, sciatica.
You can't be exempt from time like the rest of us.
No, that's true. Yeah,
he just comes out, sits on a stool, plays
and,
ass.
Nice. And that's the beauty of Kiss is that with Kiss, you just pour him into the costume.
Yeah.
And they're on wires and
they're
basically marionettes.
No matter what, the Kiss
Thunderbirds
show,
of rock.
The Kiss show is a Kiss show. And it wouldn't surprise me if even when they're too old to do it, they'll get other actors to play them.
Oh, sure.
Like, you're the demon, you're the cat.
They'll get the black guy that played Ace in Phantom of the Paradise. Not Phantom of the Paradise, Phantom of the Park.
Yeah.
Phantom Park, totally. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Demon Starchild. Anthony Zerbe stole our talismans.
You're looking for someone, but it's not Kith. Yeah, no, I love that movie. And I would tell Gene, I love that movie. He'd give me the look of like, what the fuck is wrong with you? He had a nickname for me. It was actually a good nickname. He'd call me Gomez.
That's a good one.
Yeah, that was no one's ever called me that before. Yeah. And I was like, oh, that's actually kind of clever. Gomez. What do you want? What are you gonna make a good movie, Gomez? What are you gonna make something? Why you make the schlock B crap nobody sees? We're Kiss. We do A-list. We make the whoppas of rock and roll. We make what people want whoppas. You make little B schlock.
Oh, that's brilliant. Yeah. We make whoppas. People want whoppas.
That's a direct quote. That is a direct quote.
I believe you.
We make whoppas.
People would whop us.
We're involved in A-list films, Jurassic Park, Terminator 2. He was not involved in any of those movies,
yeah, exactly.
But he's listening to me like
about?
He was.
Yeah.
Not the B-direct that you make.
Godfather, Apocalypse Now. These are movies Kiss sees.
We invented vinyl.
Yeah, now, exactly.
And are they like all on the same, do they tour together? Like, or is it like the
Gene and Paul.
The
yeah,
ones,
do,
yeah.
But the other ones
they
are just,
get, what I mean is
no,
they
they're out.
They,
oh yeah, they're yeah, fine. Yeah, yeah. Totally. The other ones are just employees.
Yeah, employees. Know, right. Yeah. Yeah. It's yeah, not like so,
put this makeup on, stand over there.
Yeah. The Eagles or something, like four jets because they can't be on the same.
Yeah. Well, Ace
can't
and
be on the same private jet.
Yeah, no.
Ace and Peter, it's been a very, very vocal.
Oh yeah, yeah, totally.
Breaking up. So
no, they're not well.
No.
Yeah, they weren't messing. I remember one day I was at Air One on Beverly Boulevard, and, mm-hmm. and they built a they moved it, and now it's in like the bottom of an apartment complex. And I don't know who I was visiting, but I was at the pool there. Kind of crappy stucco apartment complex pool. And Peter Chris is there. Nice. And I didn't know it was Peter Chris, but somebody was there. Are you Peter Chris? And he's like, yeah. And so we're like talking, and I goes, what are you doing hanging out here? And he just points to the Hollywood Hills and he goes, I got a wife and a house living there. I got a wife and a house living there. Yep, that happens.
At Monsterpalooza, Marky Ramone.
Yeah, he was walking
delighted.
Around.
Yeah. And I was so happy because back in the day when the Pleasant Dreams album came out, I'm living in San Francisco, and they're signing at the Record Factory.
Good Lord.
Yeah.
The Record Factory.
And I show up.
The warehouse.
Yeah. And I show up, and I'm going down the line, and on Pleasant Dreams, Marky Ramone played drums, but I didn't know that he had then left the band. So I get to the end, and it's this new drummer, and he signs my record. And so for years, I had the wrong drummer on the record. And I came up to Marky Ramone at Monster Blues. I go, it's been all these years and you are here to right a wrong.
Ah, nice.
And he was great about it.
Did he laugh?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, that's
at first funny. He thought I was starting trouble with him.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
There was a little bit of like, oh yeah, what? And yeah. And then I told him, and then he's like, oh, that's good. He goes, you know, anytime, like, cause it was Richie Ramone was right. on it. He goes, anytime Richie or CJ are on signed an album, it decreases the value. Yeah. But he was terrific.
That's so funny.
He went off on, Johnny Rotten, and it was great.
What did he say about Johnny Rotten?
Well, cause there was a press conference with Johnny Rotten, and it was like Rollins and Marky and a couple of the people. And Johnny Rotten got really wasted, like ugly, sloppy drunk.
Right.
And was starting shit with everybody and trying to say how like the New York scene had no relevance and really.
The New York scene started it.
I know. Right. And so like Marky Ramone was basically saying, I was this far away from punching him in the face. I was just waiting for him to come after me so I could be justified.
Malcolm McLaren went to fucking New York.
Yes. Yeah. No, it's absurd. And even the look. And they're arguing about this in this press conference too, where it was like Richard Hell was the guy that did all the, you know, safety pins and but it's a really interesting press conference if you like that.
Yeah,
stuff.
No, I do. Yeah, I do. Yeah. I go down these bottomless YouTube holes of how many live versions of Keith Moon singing Bellboy can I find? I have 11 things I need to do. Maybe I should do this. Matt, you had one of my favorite jokes about Kiss, which was the genius of Kiss was that they're a rock band and they're monsters. This is genius.
Yes.
It's
everything.
It's the two things that every 13-year-old boy loves.
Right. Yeah.
Not many bands make great action figures, but Kiss, especially even back then with Amigo figures, those were beautiful.
And they stumbled into something.
Much better than the Herman's Hermits. Yeah,
the Credence figures, you know, I don't know.
Although the Credence figures are the only action figures that had a special thing that you could hit and they would chugle.
I hear the Chuck Berry one had a squirting action.
Yeah, it had a squirting action. Chuck Berry squirt gun.
You got to get the playset.
I wonder if John Fogerty is still chuggling. I know that he was intent that
people, I hear he's a delight.
He was very intent that people keep on chuggling. I just don't know if he still is himself. but you were telling that Gene Simmons berated you once.
I don't know if I can tell that story. Yes, Gene Simmons loved to tell me how much my films will never make a dime and I will die poor. But he literally delighted in telling me this stuff. He would wow. like he sat me down for an hour and just went off about.
And then
like,
did he laugh about, after? Or is like
no, I no, like, truly like
we're you want some borscht?
I really do think it actually came from a place of endearment.
Sure,
I think he liked me.
Yeah,
but that was his way of connecting with me, telling me what a bum I am and how I should do like A-list stuff and like you know like focus on that. You know, yeah, so
like you're turning down A-list stuff,
right? Exactly. Yeah, totally. Yeah.
Oh, I should take those.
I should have done Jurassic Park. You're right.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Yeah.
Okay. Thanks, Gene. So,
Be anyway. Better. Okay,
By the way,
got it.
Jurassic Park, a movie about giant monsters.
Yeah, totally. Yes, absolutely. And then it would always leave with like, if you want a t-shirt or something, there's a bin right there.
Yeah. Hey. A bin. Yeah, let's count all the good Kiss movies.
The last James Taylor concert, he came out with a giant dragon boost. You've got a friend. You got a friend and Satan. All right, so to wrap it up, what are your all time like how you know you and I Halloween's we go to the same we do a little hayride
right.
What are the movies that you inevitably will throw on?
Well, they're like this old year, classics. And again, it really, like we talked about at the beginning of the show, it's like it's all about the 80s for me. It's like I really feel that's the obviously it's when I grew up, so it's like that's of course a magic era. But I have been a hankering for Halloween 2. Like people don't like that movie.
Interesting.
I love Halloween 2. I've seen Halloween a million times. I've seen Halloween 2 a million times. But
I saw Halloween 2 the night before my PSATs.
Nice.
Or the SATs, maybe. What year was it? Was that 81?
It was 81, yeah. I saw it on a double feature in Pasadena with it was Halloween 2 and The Fun House. And that was a life-changing day for
the
me.
The Fun House is one of my favorite movies.
But that was just, I mean, that was like youth to me. That was like you're going to see a double feature horror movie. Yeah. These great movies. And there were, you know, they were great movies. These are cool slasher films. And I think, you know, there's a part of me that's resentful of the new Halloween movie that's sort of like, forget everything else. They ain't brother and sisters. They ain't, you know, just forget all that stuff.
I don't like it.
And I'm like, how many I love Halloween 2, man.
How many have there been? It's like, there's a remake, and then there's
eight of the quote unquote original series, I suppose. Yeah. Then there's the two Rob Zombie ones, and now there's the new one, and now there's two more coming from, I guess we'll call it the new Blumhouse trilogy.
Right. Okay.
You know, so.
And they're brother and sister in that one?
No, they're only in brother and sister in Halloween 2, and that's the mythology of like the whole original thing. And then they said, we're going to undo that.
God, I didn't even remember that.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah. Because look, other than that, if you don't have the brother and sister, and again, I know it's an unpopular thing, people think it's stupid, but if you don't have the brother and sister thing, this is just some dude who couldn't get over a girl 40 years ago. Like he met on one night and he's like, I just have to kill that bitch. I just have to kill her. Fuck.
That's a good point.
You know, because other than that, it's just like, why, you know.
Otherwise, it's just the ultimate incel.
Yeah.
Halloween H2O.
Uh-huh.
That is a good movie.
That's fun. It's dated as shit.
It's dated, but it's still, but it's a good story. And I feel like it actually brings it back from all the silly weirdness that the Curse of Michael Myers
will,
and all that.
I will say that. And by far, and that series is one of the best. Have you seen it recently?
I watch it every couple of years.
Because Michael Myers is...
The mask is terrible.
He's like a Scooby-Doo villain in that one.
The mask
like,
is bad.
He's like, I can't even... It's like he's just like a caricature of himself. Like, it's funny that... And I love how these killers, like years later, it's like, yeah, that's the perfect blue jumpsuit. That matches, right?
When they were making the film, they actually had to go back and change some things because they couldn't get the mask right. Which, to me, is... just ridiculous because I mean you go into a Halloween show
yeah.
Well, there's a story of the mask here. I'm sure some of it's well known, some of it isn't. So obviously the Michael Myers mask was a Captain Kirk mask.
Right.
So the Captain Kirk mask was made by Don Post, and it was from a life cast that was made from the Ernest Borgnine classic, The Devil's Reign.
Right.
That was the life cast that was made, and then it was sculpted. And that's the mask that we know and love. And then people go like, how come it doesn't look right in the second one? In the second one, it actually is the very same mask. The thing was that the actor had a round head.
And he just kind of blew it out a little bit?
Yeah, just blew it out a bit. And it was kept under, I believe, Deborah Hill's bed for years. And she was a smoker, and it made it yellow. So that's the reason amazing. It looks different, it's actually the exact same mask from the first movie, but it's different. And then there was a question of, does William Shatner have likeness rights?
Right, yeah, sure.
For the other films, you would think
he does.
Yeah, and so I think for a while that was an issue of why they couldn't make the exact same mask.
Okay.
And then now, supposedly, as I understand, all bets are off. You can make whatever mask you want now.
Really? So, yeah. Even if it's William Shatner?
Yeah, I think so. They could, like, my understanding from the new one, they said they absolutely could have gone back with the Shatner mask, but they said, no, we wanted to do something that was very close to it, but a little different. You know, they did an awesome job of mask in the new one.
The fact that you take someone's face and then you change it somehow, isn't there some sort of legal...
That's a good question. Escape route,
you know, when it comes to rights.
And it was sculpted by Bill Malone, who is the director.
Oh, is it really?
House on Haunted Hill remake. So.
Yeah.
So anyway, there's way too much information.
That's fascinating.
I enjoy really, actually, all of those movies. I mean, to greater
like one,
or
two,
lesser,
three.
Even some of the weird ones, I like. This is so absurd that I do kind of enjoy them.
Then four feels like a 90s made-for-TV movie.
Yeah, no.
And then five and six are fucking terrible.
It's diminishing returns, granted. But even those, you know, you get me on the right day. And,
right. and then H2O kind of brings it back.
And then
the other one has Busta Rhymes.
That one is awful. Yeah, that one's terrible. That one's awful.
Happy Halloween, motherfucker.
With me, it's once you've seen Escape from New York and you've seen Donald Pleasance in a blonde wig and makeup.
Yeah, right. The Duke, number one.
It's hard to see him in Halloween. It's hard to see him not in a blonde wig.
Right.
I just wonder.
I have that calendar. Oh,
I wonder when he had that in the script.
Yeah. Jonathan,
why am I in a wig here? Hey, Blofeld, put on the wig. are you talking about like bands that you love that are older? And I love this so much. Ken Reed from TV Guidance Counselor podcast from Boston went to see Goblin.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
And he goes, it's just a bunch of old Italian guys now.
Right. Yeah. Totally.
You know, they're just old Italian guys, but they love their job. And they're just these fat old Italian guys in work shoes. And, you know,
that's another one. That's funny to me because we say that, but Goblin. They've had many incarnations too,
sure.
And then they split off, and then there was like, you know, the new Goblin. I don't know exactly how they broke it off, but
whoever's
now
in the
it's
new
just
version.
One guy from Goblin, and then
it?
Five other dudes.
Yeah, yeah, like
five other
like
Italians.
The Beach Boys, roadies, and fans.
Yeah, totally, yeah. Pretty much, you know.
But it's he goes, they come out and they go, "Are these niggas the song? Is it called Zombie?" I love that so much. They're just so happy. This next song is called Zombie.
We're so glad you made the scene. It's the Dana Gould Hour. Happy Halloween.
This has been the Dana Gould Hour, brought to you by the Internet. Music by Andy Paley, with Jake Posner behind the board. Produced by Jeff Fox. Graphic design and web production by Spencer Hunt and Segan Friend. Sound editing and post-production by Jalinda Palmer and Joe Napolitano. Hey, if you enjoyed the show, why don't you drop us a line at show@danagould.com.
Goodbye, everybody, and remember, please, for the next day or so, the terrible lesson you learned tonight.
That grinning, glowing, globular invader of your living room is an inhabitant of the pumpkin patch, and if your doorbell rings and nobody's there, that was no Martian. It's Halloween.